Surprise! Welcome out to the Cars, Bars, and Guitars podcast, episode number 40 that you were not expecting. I'm AJ.
I'm Steve.
Steve, who are we brought to you today by?
Unexpected collaborations with Toyota.
And?
Biofreeze.
You know, the last time the Germans and the Japanese got together, there was a bit of a conflict going on. Well, Steve, what are you drinking?
Oktoberfest in August.
Me too. And Steve, we have a very special guest with us, Mr.
Bryan Leighton.
Yay.
Hello, thanks for having me.
Yes. So,
at long last.
I know. We've been trying to get this together since episode 25, I think.
Funny thing, this not being a work day.
Yes, explain yourself, but that kind of explains yourself. So, Bryan,
it's really that simple.
Something Tuesday is not that good a time for him.
Well, I have a shitty schedule. You have the shittiest schedule, and he has a normal schedule. So it kind of works out for best for him. It's on the weekend. So, yep. And I had to work today. You got to work tonight?
Of course.
Fuck that. Bryan, tell everybody a little bit about yourself.
All right. Where to begin? I came to Charlotte about 7 years ago, originally from Florida. Came up here for work. And now live in a little tiny Mint Hill, drinking beer, driving cars. And I have a guitar, but I have never picked it up.
We can change that.
Okay.
I told you I could show you the ropes, man. I can show you what I know. I can show you three chords and you can get a gig tomorrow.
All right.
Well, we got Brian's brought some beers for us. Steve's brought a couple. I didn't bring shit because I've been at work and busy and taking Emily to concerts.
Then whose Oktoberfest was that?
That's leftover from that was a me collection, not a not anything else. So normally we start out with our guests, every guest we've ever had. We start out with your car history from start to finish. Now, we can go. I think we've gone cars that were exclusively driven by you.
Yeah.
Not necessarily titled in your name, but just cars that.
Thanks, Mom and Dad.
Exactly. Yeah, cars that were your cars to drive, pay for the gas, and or insurance. So start at the beginning. Be as thorough as you want to be, because Steve's had 10, and I've had 10.
I think you both beat me.
Nobody's beat us so far. Yeah.
I don't think I've actually sat down and done the math, but I started out with a 1992 Ford Ranger pickup truck. It was gifted to me by my dad on my 16th birthday. I drove that for a couple years until college, and then I got my first new car, and it was a Mazda Protege 5, and it was a 2002.
Was it the speed?
No. Oh. I wanted...
They never built the hatchback Protege with the turbo. It was only the...
That's right. That's the...
Yeah, the earliest Mazda speeds were sedans.
Gotcha. That's right. That's right. The MP3, and like the...
That's
the
exactly the one I was looking for, was the MP3. And by the time I hit the market, it pretty much did not exist anymore. Mm. So...
it was like one of the first cars with a factory MP3 CD player, yeah, and an extra 10 horsepower over, yeah, a standard Protege.
Ooh.
Huge. Versus the Mazda Speed 3 that had about a 50 horsepower advantage.
Well, you say 10, and that doesn't sound as impressive as a 10% bump in power, because that sounds better. They don't have to know that the car had an anemic amount of horsepower.
I think $1.30 to $1.40.
Yeah, yeah, that's a little better. Yeah, but we digress. So yeah, it was the 3. Okay. Mutz 5.
Yeah, little Protege 5. So I drove that through most of college. Then when I got out of college, I got my first finance job. So this was my first grown-up job. And I went to... exactly. So I went to Acura and got a 2005 RSX. I got it in the blazing orange metallic.
That's a pretty color.
It was, you know, it was funny. I was, because of the finance job, I was thinking I had to be all conservative and all this. And I was looking at a black one. And my dad's like, well, which one do you really want? I said, I want the orange one. And he said, get the orange one. So I did, and I never regretted it. I love that car. Had that for a couple of years, did some work to that one. That was when I really got into modding cars, and I, you know, did the wheels and any bolt-on I could get for the RSX. Mm-hmm. Then I traded that. I kind of got to the point where it was either I was going to supercharge or turbo it, or I was going to just step up to something bigger. So I traded it in and got an Evolution in 2008. It was the first year of the Evo X.
That was the was there a tax on that?
Pretty, yeah. Curse of tax on the new ride. The very first. We're not there yet.
No, not that. Well, yeah, that.
Yeah.
Well, the 8 came out in over here in what, 04?
Yes.
I think the 8 or
it was right about the time about right, that you could finally get an Impreza WRX, like soon after that Mitsubishi.
The 02. 02 was the first year of the turbocharged WRX here. The Bug Eye.
Yeah.
And people thought that one was ugly, and then boy, later on in that cycle it got worse. So it was so Evo. How what did you do to that?
I did a lot to that. I was I don't know what you want to consider it. Stage three. I mean, fully bolted on, tuned, pretty much everything before I had to get a new turbo.
Gotcha.
I think I was dynoed at. I think I was right about 400 horsepower.
And at the wheels, that's...
It was a monster, stout. Yeah.
Yeah,
yeah it was... I think it was a... We used to take it to the track down in Gainesville. This was back in my Florida days, and we would run, you know, 12-second quarter miles. So it was quick. It
on
was
street,
you know,
tires, right?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, that was my daily driver, so...
So you did those 6,000 RPM clutch dumps on...
Yeah. You did it anyway? Oh, yeah. Launch control, practicing launch control at 5,500, so... I actually ended up trading that in just a little bit over a year that I owned it. So I did a lot of stuff in a short period of time. And when I traded it in, the clutch was already slipping.
Mm.
I had just completely baked it. So
can't imagine. The easy miles.
Oh, yeah.
10,000
yeah.
easy miles.
Yeah, I think it had like 7,500 miles on it or something. Oh, and the clutch was completely toast.
Well, Mitsubishis are not what I would call the most reliable Japanese car ever built. I mean...
For a while, they were some of the most entertaining.
I mean, you got 1A, 1B, Honda, Toyota, and you can put those in whatever order, and then maybe Mazda.
Yeah.
And then since, after that...
Since you and Kalen have very bad Nissan experiences.
I don't like Nissan.
I mean, I do, but I now prefer the Nissans that we can't get. So I'm just waiting for 2022 to roll around so I can get an S16, or the Silvia, The pretty one, was it S15? Six? I don't fucking know my nomenclature.
16, one of those.
The pretty one. Yeah, the pretty one. But it's got drift tax. The ones over here have drift tax on it. So, like a stock 240 that's clean, under 100,000 miles, goes for 12 grand. You're like, really? Like,
yeah, you and that truck motor.
So, you went Evo 2.
So
WRX.
So this is where it gets a little bit squirrely. I had a girlfriend I was getting serious with, did not enjoy my car habit. So I decided I was going to do the responsible thing, got rid of my Evo. That's why I only had it for a short period of time, and got a Subaru Legacy, which is a Subaru Camry.
Yep.
It was big and gray and dumb. It was a CVT, which is just terrible. Pretty much just sucked all the joy out of driving
and life,
and life just in general, as if my ex-girlfriend didn't do enough of that.
When you said you did the responsible thing and got rid of, I immediately, so like, please say your girlfriend.
In hindsight, yes. So, so that lasted for a couple years.
How hard could it have been to find one of those, you know, an Outback XT?
I'm still looking.
Yeah.
The or Forester. Fozzies, yeah.
Yeah. I like those.
Oh yeah.
But the Jeep parts are cheaper. And I don't want to make the Jeep go faster. I'm going to have to do way more modification than I really want to do to it. Hey, can y'all turbocharge this 337,000 mile motor of mine, please?
Instant detonation. So from the Subaru, I got rid of once I got rid of the girlfriend, then I got rid of the Legacy, and it was literally within about 2 weeks of each other, and. I was at the dealership getting service done on the Legacy, and they had a white 2011 WRX on the lot, sedan, and did the deal right then and drove off with it. And that was, to this day, the only car that I have personally paid off And I had that car for a good 4.5 or 5 years.
Did it give you any head gasket trouble or anything like that?
No. And, you know, I'm on forums and things, and I know they have kind of a
reputation
of detonating, but I never had a single issue. And I was fully bolted on, tuned even by the Motion Lab, which is locally here I guess they're no longer in existence, but they had a better reputation of detonating engines and doing things incorrectly, but I never had a single issue.
I just wonder, the people who have issues with cars like that, like, how rough were you on that car? Like,
right.
I mean, there's a limit. Like, you can do that to a Honda engine usually, and they'll take the abuse pretty well, but those flat fours like a certain kind of, you know, every engine's like, Jeeps don't like to be to jump people off, but they can happily be jumped off. But the electricals just really don't like being jumped, like jumping other people off. So, do you got jumper cables? Yeah, but I can't do it for you.
And I think part of that's, you know, knowing your car. I mean, all the work I did to it, I'm not the kind of guy that's going to beat on it. So, you know, I drove that car for, you know, 4 or 5 years. I think I got rid of it. It had 60 to 65,000 miles on it.
Mm-hmm.
Really just never had an issue. I thought it was a great, to me, it was bulletproof.
Mm-hmm. And you probably broke it in correctly too. I wonder how many of those guys bought it brand new and
tweak it, then rub the nuts off of it.
That happened a lot with the Conquest and the Starion's, because I had a Starion, and people would buy them and they would just fucking go out and hoon the piss out of them immediately. And there's 36 feet of vacuum line on that thing, by the way.
Oh, my God.
Because emissions. So, it's funny. A bone stock one dynoed at 140 horsepower, okay? Because it only had 188 horsepower and 230 torque. But 144 horsepower. We dynoed mine at the wheels with removing all the vacuum line except the ones that I needed, which was 2 feet about this long. Vacuum advance and a fuel pressure vacuum line. That was it. Intercooler hard pipe, a 2.5-inch exhaust, boost controller, and an intake, and it dynoed at 240 horsepower.
Oh my God.
Just from doing it, because the exhaust in parts was 1 3/4 inches to keep it quiet. Like, yeah. But it was only two injectors also.
Oh my God.
It was
God.
A two injector. And only one injector worked until 3,000 RPMs. And then the second injector kicked in. This is Mitsubishi too, so you probably got out of the Mitsu.
You know, I think I saw a new Mitsubishi the other day, and
ugh.
I think I was just more surprised that the company even exists anymore or makes cars.
It was
just,
it the
that Miragio?
Was it the Mirage or the Eclipse Cross?
No, that's what it was. No, it's just terrible.
You know what? Bring back, make whatever
bring back
car
the
you
Aztec.
Want.
What?
Make what?
Because they did.
Make whatever car you want. Make whatever car you want, but don't bring it back. Don't bring the Eclipse name back and put. Yeah. That and turd in a dress.
Just ruin it. You just
exactly.
Messed up.
Very. Yeah. So you had the Scooby for 4 years.
I had the
years.
Scooby for a long time. Did a lot of work to it. Even I had that while I'd been in Charlotte. Did a lot of work here. And then for some reason got bored. Up to this point, the Subaru, every car I'd owned it was a manual. And one day I was... Because of my commute, I was sitting in traffic one day and just got completely just angry. You know, my leg was hurting at this point. I'd been in traffic for so long. So I came home and I'm like, screw this. I'm going to go trade it in and get something, you know, nice that I can just kind of sit in. It's an automatic. So I went up to Lexus dealership and got a little IS200, which was a little turbo.
Yeah, the third generation IS with the turbo 2.0 in it.
Yeah.
Those are rear drive, right?
Yes.
They're pretty cars. I like those cars.
Yeah, it was a beautiful car. Mm-hmm. I had no problem with it really inside and out. Where I had trouble with it was the power. It was to the, especially coming from a modded Subaru, right? I mean, I was used to making moves that I could safely make. And I would stomp the gas on that IS200, and the lag on that little turbo was way too much. And I was like, all right. So I knew the guy up there, and I was in there getting my first service done. I literally had the car for 3 or 4 months. And my salesman comes up to me. He's a young kid. He's like 23 years old. He's like, how's the car treating you? I'm like, it's fine. I said, but it just doesn't have any power. It doesn't go anywhere. He's like, well, let me show you this over here. and he showed me the RCF, and I just fell in love with it. I fell in love with it. So took an absolute beating on that on the car I just bought, you know, four months ago.
Yeah,
but got me into the RCF, and that was just a monster, just a monster.
What's the power on those?
It's listed at 474. 5.0 V8, but it's a moose. It's heavy.
Yeah.
So it's fast.
Once it's going. Yeah.
Yeah, but it's a freight train.
Might have been a little too old and a little too obscure to come by.
Absolutely. The guys that I know that have...
20 grand now, but they're few and far between.
True.
Yeah. And I found some. I do have some friends of mine that have an ISF, but even they won't let them go, really. So from there, I had that car... for very long, just a year and a half. So for me, I guess for me, that's somewhat long.
That's a late in decade.
Yeah, exactly. So I ended up from there. I guess I'm kind of all over the place. I ended up in a Subaru Forester. Again, it was traffic. Traffic got me again. Mm-hmm. It whittles you down until you make a stupid decision.
If I recall correctly, you said the RCF was just too much car for what you're using it for. That you can't stretch its legs. You can't
nothing.
Use this thing to its full potential. A 350 might have very well served you pretty well.
Right. Instead, I started like on the
biggest, baddest, craziest thing you could.
Right. You know, middle ground, forget that.
Yeah. Exactly. No.
I'm either, I'm in or I'm not. So, so I've had the Forester for what I thought was an eternity until my wife reminded me this weekend that it hadn't even been a year yet.
Jesus. All right.
Yeah. So obviously there's nothing exciting about a Forester. They are completely underpowered. The seats aren't even comfortable. I will give it points for visibility and gas mileage.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's just not.
Heard even that Crosstrek little brother doesn't do well on gas, and like that's
it doesn't.
Mechanically similar.
Yeah,
it doesn't.
Yeah, so this weekend, actually yesterday, I picked up the new Supra. So I feel like I'm back in the game.
Get ready for a lot of boy racers wanting to.
Yeah.
Yep.
So far, the response has been good. I get a lot of pictures taken, a lot of thumbs up. So
yeah.
I dig that kind of stuff. People really like to see it. It seems like, and I like to be the one driving it.
It's new. The thing people who say they don't like attention are either lying or extreme introverts, because I think we all kind of like some sort of attention.
Absolutely.
At some, I know I do.
I mean, a car for me actually scores a lot of points for uniqueness, right? So if I'm shopping for a car and I have a list of items I want to hit, if they're essentially equal, I'm going with the unique car.
Mm-hmm.
I like the blazing orange RSX. I liked my blue modded out Evo. Mm-hmm. I like the RCF and the Lexus kind of.
What color was the Lexus?
It was kind of that maroonish.
That's a pretty color.
It was awesome.
I like that color. But I like white car. I like white cars.
Right.
Steve doesn't.
Take it or leave it.
Steve tends to like red cars, even though he has a blue car.
I kind of fell into that one because I needed to get out from being very upside down on that truck, though.
Yep.
And 5 years later, that Vibe's still the best car I ever had.
Well, what is my least favorite color car?
Blue.
What color car do I have?
Blue. What are you still not done to it, AJ?
Painted it.
Anything else?
Well, the thing is, I have a hard time putting a nice paint job on a car I paid $1,700 for.
Yeah.
I mean, I think about Makoing it and just invite it, like taking a vacation, have everybody come over, help me just wet sand it, the Jeep, just get everything. We'll take the headlights, the taillight. We'll just strip it down to the body. We'll get all the windows taped off, and I'll take it, primer and everything, and then I'll have a paintless dent repair guy come over, just get all the little stuff out, and then just tow it to Mako and go, just want you to paint it and clear coat it. That's it.
I mean, I will say I had a, going back, actually it was the same ex-girlfriend that...
Ow, sorry. No problem. Sorry, the setup in here is different.
Not the mention of hers giving him pain.
The setup in here is different, so sorry about that.
No, but she had this old white Celica. It was I guess the new body style, but when that
the last one, like the 2000 to 05 model, the Jet Fighter.
Yes, mm-hmm. yes. And she had this thing forever. It was just white.
Was it a GTS or does it GT?
They had a GTS, but she did not.
The GTS has the same engine as mine, the 1.8 RPM one.
Yeah. But she took it to Mako. And granted, my expectations were extremely low.
Of course.
But for a $400 or $500 paint job, I thought they actually did a pretty good job.
Yep. But the thing is, I want to change the color. And I'm probably either going to... I'm thinking about doing that. I thought about white, but then I showed Steve that that Civic color, that titanium bluish, grayish kind of... Did I show you that?
No.
Okay.
I do not recall that color at all.
Well, she is. I got so the technology.
Go from blue to blue? What?
It's blue-gray. I mean, so let's see. Civic color gray.
Is that on a new model?
No, new-ish, I think. I forgot the name of the color. I think it was... Every time you're actually looking for something, but you really can't find it. Blue. It was like a blue-gray, gunmetal-y, fucking... God damn it, motherfucker. No, thank. People also ask, what is the best color for a Honda Civic? I don't care what people ask about that. I'm looking for...
Not beige.
It was that color.
Drew's 1990.
Oh, yeah, I know that
beige.
Color.
Yeah, I think that color would look good on the Jeep.
Yeah.
Battleship gray.
Yeah.
I like it.
I do, too. The thing is, I wanted the door jam. I'm probably going to I'll do the door jams in black. I'll just do them myself and then just take it to Mako and just have them fucking do it. Because I don't want blue and then blue. Blue and black is fine. Yeah. But blue in a different shade of blue, it's a bit trailer trashy. Pardon the pun, it's a bit Florida, man. The bad part of Florida.
Hey, I mean, I grew up there. I know all about Florida, man.
Oh, I know. When people talk about rednecks, I'm like, look, I can't defend it. I grew up around them. I mean, you kind of didn't. Not really.
The magic of being from a bigger city, this dumb state, but we're surrounded. Much
but
like
now we
here,
but now we surrounded. Live, yeah, we live in the biggest city now. We're still surrounded. So.
Going home, I'll... go down Bartlett Road, and there's that, turn this way or that way sign. Mm-hmm. It's shot up. Like, yeah, stay classy, Mint Hill.
Exactly. Hey, so you told me off mic it was now your favorite car you've had.
It is.
And it probably should be.
Yeah.
It's the newest. It's the rarest.
Yeah. You know, it's listed, because people keep asking me for horsepower numbers. It's listed at 335.
And surveys have said this feels faster than that number would suggest.
Yes. And it goes back to the Lexus of 474. I think the Supra would be the RCF off the line, absolutely.
And it's lighter,
probably
too.
500 pounds fewer.
Yeah.
Because there's a lot of creature comforts.
And it feels like it. Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, didn't they? I thought they dynoed it, and or some they tested it, and it was all. They said it was making more than that, and the number really escapes me right now because they did that with it. Like the original Vipers were rated at 450, and DeMuro had one that had 50,000 miles on it, bone stock, and dynoed it, and it dynoed at 460 something at the wheels.
Oh wow!
Yeah, so
yeah,
it had a 97
GTS, and it was bone stock, and it dynoed at the wheels more than it was at the crane when it was brand new. So I mean.
Jeez. And I've seen torque numbers on the Supra of 400 or so.
Oh, really? So those are more torquey than... Okay. Yeah. So you probably feel that. I mean, you just...
Definitely.
Straight for miles. Probably a flat torque curve. It's going to be a really nerdy podcast today, guys. Sorry about that. It's too bad Mark's not here, because Mark would be picking your brain about, so what's your toe in and your camber?
I know none of those answers.
Mark
started to pick up the protractor.
Mark said he couldn't wait to listen to this episode because I gave him a heads up. But I was like, Mark, you need to come get your fucking bottle of vodka because I really want to drink it because I don't even like vodka. But that was some damn good vodka.
Also got a Raspberry Pi for him, too.
That's true, too. any plan? You said you didn't much care for the wheels. Not as much as...
I don't, only because, and you saw them in the people that... that have seen the non-launch edition, which I love the wheels on the launch edition. They're just straight black.
Okay.
Which I love, because especially with the white, I think the classic combo. Mm-hmm. But the GR wheels have these, and they're nice, don't get me wrong, but they have a polished chrome, spine down each spoke of the wheel, and I'm just not a chrome guy. So I'll probably...
Plays Firefox myself.
So I'll probably end up replacing those down the line. I mean, on my blue Evo, I had bronze wheels, mm-hmm. which was a fantastic combo. On Always. My white WRX, I had blue wheels, actually, which was pretty...
Neon blue or like the...
No, they were kind of like a deep...
Okay. Because you've seen what I'm talking... like the
Similar
the,
to your controller sitting over there?
Okay. I was thinking more like neon, like the ones see on Stance car where they put those super like bright...
The
fucking,
Meisters or whatever they want to call them? Or
Yeah. Something like that.
Not like that. Not like that.
Why don't you rock the powder blue?
I would, absolutely.
You would like...
On a white car, those would look fantastic.
You think so? Yeah. I'd have to see it. I'd have to see it.
Yeah, why not?
I'd have to see it.
Yeah. Maybe I'll powder coat the ones I have and do that.
I don't think you should do that.
Make up your mind, man.
Keep an open mind, man.
Yeah, but with a white car, I have really unlimited options. So.
That is true. I mean, I just like white cars just because they always look clean.
Yep.
Even my silver one. It looks clean, but it's not. It doesn't have that same. I just like white cars. Don't ask me to explain it.
I'm with you on that.
I just do.
I'm with you.
So, that's a very back and forth from two very specific brands for a little while. But that's one of the more interesting car histories. I'd say Max was pretty regular. It was Ford, Acura, Honda.
I had a Volkswagen in there too.
That's right. He had the Jetta?
Yeah, a Jetta that got manual swapped and then probably crashed. I had a GTI of slightly older vintage and it too got crashed.
It seems to be a purveying thing.
I don't remember much
here.
About the movie Minority Report except wrecking my car right before I saw it.
You just cruised right into that, didn't you?
That's it.
So do you like the paddle shift in it?
I haven't used it yet.
Oh, did you just put it in auto mode?
Yeah.
Gotcha. I've never driven a paddle. Have you? You've valeted some.
I've never tinkered with that feature.
When you valet, you just put it in auto.
Just plunk it in drive. Like, the other day I had my first McLaren.
Oh, fuck. Which one?
Nice. A 720S, so.
Nice.
Went big and stayed at work.
So, what is the interior as bonkers as... I figured
it was. I was just like, asked the guy, it's like, all right, I don't know where the e-brake is to release on this. Like, all right, the buttons are like down here, but the switch is over here to take e-brake off. That it's automatic with paddles, but there's no park feature. So you have to put it in neutral and then cut it off and then e-brake it to make sure it stays in place. So that's how much denial they are. Like, it's going to be a faster transmission.
That's the shitty part of a smaller manufacturer like that. I mean, then you get like James May's like, you know, Mercedes has a million people that decide where this button goes, and then he goes, somebody at Maserati just turns up on a Tuesday and go, right there's okay.
Or Saab, right? Like, we'll just start
the keys down here. Yeah.
Well, no the sense. Idea behind that was, in the case of a wreck, you're not getting impaled by your keys. Nobody else has adopted that philosophy.
And also that you can sit down and take your keys out and just go straight into the ignition instead of moving your hand.
Or which nowadays is you've got the keyless remotes and then the button just keeps vanishing, like going every other which way on them.
I will say that kind of surprised me the most. The Supra, even beyond the RCF, I think there's more tech in this car. Yeah.
What year was the RCF?
It was a 2016.
Well, I mean, basically 4 years is still a lifetime of tech. I mean,
it is. I mean, I get into my wife and I went out to dinner last night. I just got the car.
How do I get out of this thing?
Yeah. But we're at dinner.
Start my first C7.
But we're uptown at dinner, storms start coming in.
Mm-hmm.
And I start panicking, you know, because I'm like, I don't know where the lights are. I don't know where the windshield wipers are. I don't know shit about this car at this point. Like, we need to go. And we did. And we booked it out of there and got caught in the rain. Luckily, everything is essentially automatic at this point. So everything was working fine. But I didn't realize how quickly I got behind just by spending a year in a Forester. You know, now I don't even have a car key. You know, I'm back to keyless, which I was used to. And then it took me forever to get used to having a key. where I would just sit in the Forester with the keys in my pocket and be like, all right, do something.
Do a thing. Yeah. So now Kaylin's CRV has that too, and bouncing between her car and my car. Like, all right, so in her car, that's the e-brake. In my car, that's the clutch.
Yep.
Don't attempt the clutch to CRV.
Big difference.
Or like everyone going on about dual clutch transmissions. Well, then I'm thinking like that Ranger that I borrowed that had the floor-mounted e-brake and a clutch, so you have the four pedals across.
Dual clutch is four pedals, right?
Dual clutch is four pedals, man.
How do you do this?
You gotta hit both at the same time.
That's it.
So you can go back to the Stone Ages and go drive the Jeep where you still have to put the key in the fucking lock and unlock the door and then open it. I think it has a keyless entry, but the fob didn't come with it. And I just haven't bothered to like order the fob for it.
You didn't spend the $2 at Pull Apart to pick one up?
No, the computer for the fob is in the Jeep. I just don't have the fob for it.
Right.
So
it would cost you $2 to get the fob. How you reprogram it is an entirely different barrel of monkeys.
Oh, Jesus. And I bet the computer to reprogram it's probably this big and like one person has it.
What if the computer
like I just picture
you.
This whole room of computers and they just come up and insert this key. It's like,
yeah, we finally have something to do.
Yeah. Like your engine
paper readout
50s.
Comes out.
Yeah. And you have to use an interact to program it.
The clippy, the little Microsoft clip from Windows 95 shows up.
Oh, Stigno.
But there's, and I'm not an anti-technology guy, because I think most of that stuff is, I mean, rain-sensing wipers and the headlights and the backup cameras, that's all good stuff. But there's something to me that's super nostalgic about getting in a car that not hardly anything can go wrong in.
Now, it's funny you say that.
Oh, you can cough or fart or piss in the mic. Okay. I don't care.
So I've already turned off some things. And here's one thing I didn't realize the car had.
Start, stop. I hate start, stop.
No, it's the lane assist. Have you guys driven with that shit?
No, I haven't.
Interesting how, it, like, if you're drifting out of your lane, it'll beep at you.
Really?
No, mine will physically correct me. So I'll be changing lanes or something, and if there's a strong enough line as you're trying to exit
ever.
Yeah,
or something, it's resisting. It's wanting to put me back into the lane.
Jeez.
And I understand safety, you know, alerts and things, but when you're physically changing my driving, I don't like that. So I turn that shit off.
How hard is that?
It was super easy.
Just probably just go in the infotainment and...
Yeah, yeah. No. Like, yeah, this big screen, you find all your settings and you can turn off and on what you want. But so at least they give us that option. But
that
when it was first happening, I didn't realize what was going on. I'm like, I need like an alignment or...
They need to make things. Yeah, I mean, they need to make things. Like, if you're going to buy the car, I mean,
at you as it does that?
Yes.
Okay.
I think most of them do.
My uncle's got a 2017 RAV4 that has some version of that to, hey, check this out.
Okay. Which, you guys are probably like me. You're an active driver. I don't need that shit.
Yeah. No.
I don't need to know there's someone in front of me. Like, I don't need the car to alert me that there's a pedestrian.
You know, nothing makes you more careful driver than an active airbag recall or expired insurance.
Yep. We have, there's two people in this house now that have the Takata airbag who are driving cars that don't have the recall done, and that would be Emily and him, because my S2000 did not have that airbag in it and never was on the recall for some reason. I think for the reason is because both of your cars were built in America.
Yeah.
And mine was built in Japan. Yours was built in Japan.
Yes.
Austria.
Yeah.
True.
Mm. Tell Arnold we said hey. He lives in Cali now, so it doesn't count.
Yeah. Oh, well.
He became governor of a state he couldn't pronounce.
Go ahead and name another Austrian that's alive, rather.
Oh. That joke's really Hitler miss. Any plans for modification?
Yeah,
of course.
There always is, you know.
So the exhaust. How's the exhaust note? Is it?
It sounds good.
Yeah,
it sounds good. It sounds good outside the car. It also sounds good inside the car. The road noise is actually very nice.
I don't know how much
sound like wet farts. They really dropped the ball on that. Like at least the soup sounds good.
And then they pipe in the wet fart noise into the speaker, which that's the worst feature. I'd rather have lane assist all day and not be able to turn it off than have fake exhaust noise piped into my speaker.
I think I just learned about that last year.
Who thought that was a good idea.
I was so disappointed. You know,
the car's so heavily insulated, just leave it be.
Yeah, just leave right. it quiet, man. If you wanted a loud car, buy the loud car. But
yeah, or roll your windows down.
Exactly.
Do something. Plenty of options.
Or put a long one of those ear funnel all the way to the back.
Speaking of, do you know how expensive stethoscopes are? Yep. Root of all things had one for 130. Like, holy shnikes.
$130?
Yeah.
Yeesh.
Yeah, and that's on the cheap site.
Jesus Christ. We can go to wish.com and then buy a stethoscope from China that will get shipped by donkey and yeah, get here in 6 years.
Yeah.
You can buy anything on wish.com. Some things you maybe wouldn't want to buy, but
I wish this would get here more quickly.
Ooh, I like that. So, Bryan, are you needing beer yet, or are you still good on that one?
Yes and yes.
something
I'm good at this,
zone.
But you want to...
Yeah, let's pop out something. Let's see what you brought, man. We went through your car history pretty good, and I got to be... I'm not going to drag Steve into this, because one of these episodes we did, I kind of shit on the Supra a little bit. But that was honestly until I saw it in person, because I've never seen one in person before.
I don't blame you. I was the same way. When it first came out, I was actually very disappointed because I thought that even after all this time that Toyota had blown it, mm-hmm. honestly. And with it being such an iconic car, I was actually very disappointed. But it grew on me, and then I started reading the numbers on it and the specs on it and how it's actually performing. And once I actually did the deal before I actually saw it in person. So
oh, wow.
thank God I was wrong.
Well, I like what
did,
you
did
said.
Did that get marked up out the wazoo on you or
no,
badly?
Maybe that, because you ordered it instead of.
No, that's out there. So when I started really searching a couple weeks ago, I blanketed Charlotte, every local Toyota dealership, trying to get information. Most of the time I was being blown off. One guy just sent me the brochure for the car. I'm like, yeah, thanks, Dick.
You can download this on the internet right. anyway.
Yes,
you
I
want.
Know what a Supra is. That's why I'm wanting to figure out how to fucking get one. So one guy took me seriously. It was a guy, Scott Clark. Actually wonderful to deal with. And it just so happened that they were only upcharging about $1,800.
Jeez, that's nothing.
Which is nothing. Like some of the guys,
10 or 20,
even locally is 10 plus over MSRP. And then I've seen actually some of these launch editions being listed for $85,000 to $100,000 on a $58,000 car.
I'll paint my own mirrors.
Absolutely ridiculous. Right, especially launch edition because it's really just cosmetic.
Yeah.
All right, so let's get to beer real quick.
All right.
I think there were, three trim levels, like a standard, premium, and launch edition, right. And the premium is the one to get.
That's the one I got, yeah. Because the premium actually has, I feel like, legitimate upgrades. Whereas the launch edition, like, sure, I don't have, you know, this special little badge on my dash or red mirrors, but I kind of don't want the red mirrors anyway.
Exactly. And I don't want to pay, the only reason I would pay extra for, a low VIN or something if I was just going to put the car away and never drive it.
Right.
If you plan on using it and driving it, then getting a low VIN, it's not gonna hold any fucking value.
Doesn't matter, right? Exactly. I'll leave that for the collectors. Right?
Oh, exactly.
Exactly. That's my daily driver. So
Jesus Christ,
you're driving
brave,
the shit out
man.
Of
that's
me.
You're coming from a guy who's driven his car 700 miles this year. not this year. This calendar, the last 365 days, yeah. It was 700 miles. When I got my car inspected, it was only 700 miles worth of difference. The best driver, I know I'd bought the best driver's car arguably ever made at the price point, and I don't drive it, but I digress.
That doesn't kill you? To see it and not drive it?
Steve, I told Bryan this when he got here. I looked at a white CR.
Mm-hmm.
Because I saw his white car. I'm like, God damn it. I went on Auto Trader. I was like, I can find a white CR. They had a white CR. With 14,000 miles, $60,000 now. That car would have been 30 grand all day long when I bought mine in 2013. Now I'm kicking my own ass for not buying a CR at the time. Because as soon as somebody paid 60 grand, I'd be like, here you go. Fuck it. Take this mm-hmm. damn car for $60,000.
Yeah.
Oh, my God. So what you got for us right now?
All right. So I've had one you guys have probably had, Sounder CBS.
We'll gladly have it again if you're. Okay. But
this is one of those beers that I always just have to share.
Mm-hmm. That's a
It's a big bottle. Like
it's a big bottle of
thirsty
bottle. 12% or yeah.
It's funny that the Matrix is the Canadian version of my car.
That is true. That it.
Then I have
and get my druthers. I would totally pick another one of those up.
I have a really old El Catador bottle from 2016 ish.
Ooh.
It's called Storming of the Florida Blanca. It's a strong dark with licorice and rum.
Oh my.
Don't let the licorice scare you.
Because
good, because that is a legit concern.
For most people, yeah. It is. But.
I don't mind anise or licorice at all. So that's perfectly acceptable.
Okay.
Come on, rookie.
Last one, and I actually wasn't a huge fan of it because I'm not a huge fan of this style in general. So I figured if you guys were, it'd be a perfect time to share it. It's a triple.
Triple
good.
We like triples. So which triple have you had that you didn't like? Because we have a Three Most Philosophers, but the Three Philosophers is a quad, isn't it?
Yeah.
Now quads I like.
Okay.
It's a quad.
Do you guys like sours?
No. Oh, there goes my rubber band ball.
No.
Oh, it almost fell. Nice. It didn't fall. Yeah, sorry, guys.
What's it going to do? Bounce?
Now, it says this was blended with an American sour, but I don't recall it being.
Steve, I hate to make the executive decision, but I kind of want to do that storm in Florida and see what that's all about.
Let's do it.
There are no wrong answers here.
I don't think so either.
Worst case, if we don't like it, we throw it out.
Yep. That was last week. That not all beers on discount are created equal. The some sort of coffee stout that had gone very, very wrong.
Oof, gross.
Instead of the other coffee stout that had gone very, very right.
It was High Wire. It was High Wire Strong Man Coffee Milk Stout, which we've had before and is fantastic. And for some reason, it got
this
skunked.
This tasted like spent tires.
Man, oh, God, yeah. It was terrible.
Man, High Wire makes good stuff.
Yeah, they do. And that was mess. Yeah. I'll tell you what, the Taj Mahal Indian beer, that was fucking great.
Where'd you get that?
Food Line.
Really?
Yeah. It was cheap. Like, it was $3 for that bottle.
Shit.
Not a bad Indian lot. And it was dot Indian, not Wawa Indian.
It wasn't a set. What was it, Seven Tribes Brewing out of Cherokee?
It was a country that America it was a group of people America hasn't taken over yet. That was Britain who did that. So we'll do that one. So that's a Cigar City. Oh,
got you covered.
Steve's got the.
I'm wearing it.
I'll show you the fancy bottle opener downstairs, but
I don't have one on my keychain anymore. Last one I had. Snapped in half.
I need to put one. Like, that was $50 on Craigslist. It's technically a wine chiller. He's like, yeah. It won't get your beer super cold, man, but it does an all right job. And I'm thinking, I don't want to drink my beer like
beer super cold.
No, I want it just cold enough. I mean, yeah. So.
That's where I keep all my beers in a wine.
Exactly.
Anywhere from 45 to 55.
And now Steve gave me the PS2, and I've been playing GT3 on it. And I've never played GT3 because I beat 100% of Gran Turismo.
Did 100%,
all the rally, and I got gold on 50, and I got all the gold licenses except for the super license. I didn't get all the golds on that, but now I'm 60% of the way done for GT3. I can't stop when I start a project or anything, and it's my personality type. I cannot stop. So like I did my garage last year when I got home from California for 11 days straight. I would go to work and come home and immediately hang drywall and paint and mud and do all, like I could not stop. And I
wish I had that.
No, you don't.
I can quit something so easy, man.
I can't do it, man.
Easy to quit.
No, I have to keep going. Like I cannot stop.
Yeah.
When I start something, and there are days I wish I could, but then I get a lot of shit done if I really, really want to get shit done.
Yeah. Yeah, I have to be in the mood for it. But I mean, like I said, me learning to play guitar was buying a guitar, and I have done nothing since then.
I can show you piece of cake, like, because most of the time people don't even give a fuck how good of a, like, when we play, like, we pick songs intentionally most of the time that are easy to play, just because. Steve, read it all about it.
After pillaging and plundering the Florida coast on his ship, the Florida Blanca, Tampa's infamous pirate, Jose Gaspar, ran afoul of a pirate hunting schooner, the USS Enterprise. What, the Star Trek?
Did you say Gaspar?
Gaspar.
No one drinks like Gaspar goes to like Gaspar.
That town next to us, Gasparnia. 1821. The Florida Blanca was stormed by the U.S. Navy, signaling the end of the pirate ship and end of the pirate himself. We brewed a strong dark ale with licorice root to commemorate his fall in Asian rum barrels, the only vessel appropriate for a beer bearing the name of Tampa's most beloved pirate ship.
Nice. And will this earn a Hall of Fame place on our table?
Is that what this is over here, Hall of Fame?
That's the Hall of Fame.
It used to be the everything, and then we quickly ran out of table.
Well, and then we got a bigger table, and then we ran out of table again.
So we do have some good stuff over here.
There's really good stuff. And then there's interesting. Like, the best tequila I've ever had was that bottle.
This little guy?
Yep, that was so fucking good. That did not bite back like normal tequila does. And then the other bottle, that little bottle, is from Bosnia, and everything is in Bosnian. My Bosnian co-worker, my full-timer, he brought it back. And it kind of tastes like paint thinner and fingernail polish.
Is it like vodka style?
I couldn't
tell. Or is it light, dark?
Medium.
It looked... yeah. It looked... medium. It was rum-colored. So it was Captain Morgan colored, but it was just like... as soon as you took a shot of it, it just like... like the ends of your hair started turning like warm.
Oh jeez!
It's like, what the fuck is he trying to kill me? And like, so, cheers from storming the Florida Blanca. Yeah, cheers. Yes.
Thanks for having me.
Oh yeah, absolutely. I don't taste any licorice.
Oh, it's definitely more sweet rum.
Yeah.
Kind of chocolatey.
I like it. Well, Cigar Generally, City doesn't.
Yeah.
Do anything bad? I mean.
And
Cigar City's
mellowed over the years, too. Yeah, Tampa.
I think it was, a collaboration with Oscar Blues that is how they're able to sell beers here now. And prior to that, we'd been at Nantahala years ago, and their buddies with the folks at Cigar City would have a generous spread with which to share.
Awesome.
Oh, yeah. Have you listened to any of the episodes? You can be honest. Have you listened to any of the episodes?
I have not.
All right. So we did an episode. We talked about going to Nantahala for... Trail Magic 24.
One of the Trail Magics years ago.
Me, it was us two, and then Brendan, Matt. Yeah, Matt, Toby, and fucking Brendan Justin. Yeah, who's a very strange guy. I ended up getting cuddled by him at 3 a.m. because we all shared beds. Well, you and Toby slept on the floor.
That was the wisest move that weekend.
I get, like, have you ever had a grown man who's shirtless and 300 pounds roll over and put his arm around you when you're sleeping?
I sure haven't.
Not pleasant.
I might have been that guy once or twice.
But. everybody else showed up because what they do is they release their Trail Magic on draft that Friday at 8 p.m. And then the next day at noon, when they open, they release it in the limited edition bottles. So at 8 p.m., they always, when they tap everything in their little side room, they have a tasting party. You bring whatever beers you want, and then everybody gets, you get to talk about them, you get to share them with this group of people. And maybe there were six of us, and I think other than us six, maybe 20 people total, I would say. And the people pouring drank too. The people that are working there drank too. It's in the mountains, nobody gives a fuck. And, everybody else shows up with
all
cans.
The proceeds for that event were going to charity. It's like a $10 admission.
Yeah, it was $10 to drink. At that, it was 40 beers.
Oh my god!
We tried 40
different
beers.
I think our crew had brought half of them.
Oh yeah, we brought
boys came to party.
Yes, that's what they said. Man. We brought growlers and like tall boy cans and tall bottles. Everybody else is bringing like little cans and like just shit like we come, boom.
Oh man,
we're ready to start drinking. And we ate them out of food the next day at Iron Skillet.
Yeah,
that was great. You need to go to that. That shit's so much fun, too.
That sounds fantastic.
It's fan wonderful. This is really, really good. I like this. And the ABV's, what was it?
Sufficient.
Usually they don't list it on the bottle, but I can look it up.
You're right. I don't know why I decided to look. I just kind of wanted to see the bottle.
11.3.
Oh, yeah, that's low gravity. It's fine.
Totally sessionable.
Of course. I wonder what the highest session beer in existence now is.
I think that's a personal preference.
Yeah, I think anything advertises session, 4, 4.5. Idea being that you can make it a session. You know, stretch your drinking out all day. Yeah. That's why a lot of English beers are not particularly strong.
Terrible.
You can drink all day and not get completely hammered.
What bothers me is ESB beers are not bitter. Why is it called that?
It's extra special, so it's less bitter. What? I don't know, but I like that style.
So, Andy, you don't know Andy, from On the Border. He's a big bourbon guy. He's part owner of a racing horse in Louisville, Kentucky. Like, he and 199 other people.
Oh my god!
Like, so, and he has like a monthly. A horse?
So he owns a hoof.
It's a monthly. They have a monthly payment for their horse that to room and board and feed and train and everything. So
holy cow!
But he gets proceeds. Like, they almost won one of the satellites to go into the Derby last year. So one of his horses almost went to the Derby, which is cool. I mean,
that's pretty awesome.
Yeah. But he was talking. He said one of his buddies went to the doctor and he had high blood pressure. And the doctor was like, "Do you smoke and drink?" He's like, "Well, I have a cigar probably once a month or twice a month." And I have a couple cocktails or beers. He said, "How much do you drink?" He's like, "Maybe 6 drinks a day." And the doctor was like, "Well, that's kind of a lot, man." So they ran the blood work and everything. And like, but everything came back fine. His liver enzymes were fine. They came back. And the doctor came back in. He's like writing on his pad. And he looks up at the guy. I wrote down a number here, and you can call this person, and they can, you know, help you with your problem. And the guy goes,
"Problem?
What fucking problem?"
I don't have a problem. I love it.
Well, he told Eddie, he's like, "Man, he's like, I might be doing damage to myself, but he's like, I don't drink and drive. I go to work on time. I'm professional when I show up. And if I want to go home and have myself some drinks, I'm gonna have myself some drinks, man." I was like, "You know what? Kudos, man. Like Dennis Leary said, you're only taking the years off of your life at the end that fucking suck when you're pissing and shitting yourself when you're 80 years old.
I'm gonna go out on a high note, man."
Exactly. So I went to a concert last night. Went to 3 Days Grace, Chevelle, Breaking Benjamin, and then Dorothy played. Dorothy was awesome.
Do I know their songs?
No, I didn't know their songs. You didn't and the know girl their songs. Singing, gorgeous. But then the voice that came out was very...
Most unusual Kansas cover band.
Was very... Janis Joplin-y, like, bluesy. It was great. It was really...
You say Joplin, I'm not immediately thinking pleasant to my ears.
Okay, it was that kind of, like, a little rough, but still... She was a better singer than Joplin. Like, Joplin was more of the show woman, you know, stuff like that. I gotta tell you, 3 Days Grace put on a much better show than I thought they would. Only really? Because I'm not a big Matt Walsh fan. This might be you're not a big modern rock fan. Yeah. But
that's one of those bands I've heard of, but couldn't name a song of theirs.
Because they replaced the lead singer, right?
Adam Gonyer left abruptly. Yeah. And then they replaced it with Matt Waltz, who was the singer of My Darkest Day, which is a fucking atrociously horrible fucking group. It's like bro rock metal, like in the strip club.
Bifinger Death Punch?
It might be worse.
Rat rock?
Yeah. Okay. But Matt Waltz is the...
Rat rock? What, Dave Matthews?
Matt, 3 Days Grace's bassist is Matt's brother. So when when Adam Gontier left, but they put on a good show. So and it reminded me, the best shows we've been to, what concerts were the most memorable, or maybe bands that you saw that you weren't necessarily expecting to enjoy the show, but then you were like, "All right, I don't even really like their music that much, but that was a fucking killer show." So. Anybody?
I have two.
Okay.
I have two. Talk about being all over the place. The first one was Kid Rock. And I think anyone that's seen Kid Rock in concert knows what I'm talking about. Because he's not someone that I listen to on the regular. But I had a good friend of mine for his birthday. His parents got him tickets for a concert in Tampa. We were coming back from college and we stopped in to go to the show. And it was Fuel opening for Kid Rock, and very interesting crowd. Very, very interesting crowd.
Sounds like it.
But Kid Rock puts on a hell of a show, and he runs around, he plays every instrument. Very, very talented guy.
Mm-hmm.
That first radio hit of his was an interesting take on Blue Moon. My name is Kid Rock.
I mean, he comes rising out of the stage wearing this ankle-length white fur coat with this top hat with both middle fingers in the air and just comes rising out of the stage, and it was just nonstop for the entire concert. I was very impressed. The second one, oh, God, you guys are going to kill me for this, but Cher. I went and saw Cher in Tallahassee. Now, mind you, this was her farewell tour while I was in college.
The first farewell?
It's the Kiss effect.
Yes.
The farewell
tour. It's the never-ending. This was 2004, probably. And that bitch is still farewell touring.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm kind of upset about it because I spent, at that time, at college, I'm working at a restaurant, right? Making, dick for money. And I paid $85 a ticket to take my girlfriend there. And here she is still touring. I felt like I paid a premium because it was like, we'll never see her again.
I don't believe
and you could go to the current farewell tour and spend $200 a ticket.
Exactly. I mean,
I don't believe.
Saw Elton John a few months ago, and that was pricey.
Yeah, but she put on a hell of a show.
Dude,
I couldn't deny it.
I'm not buying. I will never go to a farewell tour, and I'll tell you why. It is because of that, but let me tell you why people never stop playing, and it's because that's all they know. Elton John doesn't need to fucking play. He's got so much money. He's got more money.
You think Cher's worried about money?
No, none of them are worried about money. That's all they know. I don't ever get tired of playing.
Right.
There are nights where it's a shit crowd, but then we get to the last song, and I'm like, you know what? I got. There are worse ways to make money.
Yep.
I'm getting paid to do something fun. I know how many people get to do that. So, and that's on a bigger, much bigger scale. That's how they are. They get to entertain, and And their fans are going to love. They're going to play the same. I mean, Chevelle played The Red last night. How many times have they played The Red live?
And they
a fucking million
they
times.
They couldn't play it enough either.
No.
Fantastic.
And what I don't like is when because I'm a big Silverchair fan.
Yes.
But they got away from their early stuff to where Daniel Johns wouldn't play any of Frog Stomp.
Really?
Oh, yeah.
Just because he got tired of playing.
Or Freak Show. He said, that was my high school band. I was young. I was a kid when I wrote that. Those were kids' songs, and I'm an adult now. But
that's what made him.
That's what made you, man. I mean,
Silverchair.
Fucking what made you.
Yeah, you better play that shit. That's like Radiohead not wanting to play
anything
Creep.
On Pablo Honey. They don't play anything on Pablo Honey.
Yeah.
And I get it. I mean, I get it.
Sure.
I listened. When I did my album, there were the original five songs I had written with the very, very first band. I scrapped three of them. I was like, they're just not good. Two of them I kept. I'm like, these are really fucking, these are not bad. And I kept them, and I didn't even hardly change anything. I would happily play those songs, happily. Enjoy it, and I'd never get tired of it. There are songs I never get tired of playing, like cover songs. They're just timeless songs.
Yeah.
And I imagine the artists have got to feel the same way, especially since they wrote it.
I would hope. I mean, I understand. Bands will definitely go through an evolution throughout their career, right? So, but having said that, if I go see Pearl Jam and they don't play Jeremy, I'm going to be fucking pissed.
That someone's getting Jeremy'd.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. I don't care how much you hate it. You better grit your teeth and play that fucking song.
And that song is a lot more intricate in its melody and its instrument. Like, there's a cello in it.
Oh, no shit.
Yeah. All right, so when it starts right before, and it hit me with a surprise lap, you can hear the cello start.
Oh, that.
Yeah, you can hear it. There's so many different, and there's a lot of dissonances. And you know what a dissonance is?
No.
It'd be like if Steve was singing an A and I was singing an A flat, mm-hmm. and we would sing it together, and it would sound not great. In the chorus in Jeremy, there's a part where the guitars are playing two way different things.
Purposely, obviously, yeah.
Yeah, and then it catches, I didn't even know, I have a background in music, and I didn't even notice it until I watched Rick Beato's video. And now every time I hear Jeremy, I fucking hear it. I can't unhear it.
Yeah, the song dissections have become our new obsession between Rick Beato and Christian James Hand, doing track by track that goes into a song. Like, bet you didn't know that this is in here.
Yeah, there's isolated,
super. Yeah. Some of these little percussion bits. Like, did you know that someone was playing bongos in this song? Mm-hmm. What?
In Spoon Man, and in Vaseline. Yeah. There's an acoustic guitar in the mix,
just buried somewhere.
Yeah, and when you take it out, you notice it.
Yeah,
but the acoustic guitar is there for clarity. It if you're doubling what's played with the acoustic, it brings the guitars out better, and you can't really notice it until you notice it, and then you'll never not notice it ever again.
Yeah, I get that.
The first part of Jeremy, that dun 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 dun, that's a 12-string bass.
Pardon.
Yeah, that's a 12-string bass.
That's like triple the strings of a bass.
Yeah. Well, there's a 12-string guitar in there. That's Toby's 12th string. So just imagine, like, and there's a bass, but just imagine each string has 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. Have you ever seen a 12 string guitar?
No, hell no.
You're about to. We got the technology.
Because you have eyeballs.
May not be in tune. That's 12 string.
Okay, that was not what I was expecting. That's a lot of sound out of there.
Yeah. So these are octaves.
But I was expecting it to be much wider, but it's actually just the fret and everything.
Everything's tighter.
Those are octaves. These are octaves. Those are octaves. Those are octaves. These are doubles.
So you still kind of play. So do you play each octave as if it was its own
string? But sure. It is different.
But you get a lot more sound out of it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's out. It's way out of tune, and I'm not even going to try to tune a 12-string guitar by ear. those the top strings are in tune.
Now, do a lot of people play that more than we think?
No, the intro to Dead or Alive is on a 12-string.
Okay.
That's on a 12-string.
That was the last CJH session.
Oh, really? Rolling Stones was the last Beato. I haven't watched that yet because I'm not a huge Rolling Stones fan. But
I'm not either.
Yeah, I like Paint It Black. And Paint It Black. Start me up, I'll tolerate. Look, well, there you go.
Just not Beast of Burden. Woof.
Yeah, you hate that song. I don't mind that one.
I'm kind of with you, though. I'm just really not a fan. Honestly.
No, the Beatles had the good sense to split after 1970, and after about 72, the Stones might as well have.
Yeah.
Mick Jagger looks fucking like a scarecrow now. Like, yeah. He's still super skinny, but now he's old, but he's really wrinkly. Keith Richards is practically dead.
Iggy Pop pulls off.
Yeah, but he's
better.
Been, I mean, Keith Richards, he's been practically dead for like 15 years.
And Keith Richards mixed in his dad's ashes in Coke one night and snorted his own father.
So now he's immortal.
Yeah. Please think about what kind of planet we're leaving for Keith Richards.
Yes, he will outlive us all.
Oh man,
what if his heart's even beating, or if it just is like it just he's just pickled his all of his organs, his brain's
or
just going to live forever.
The heart's gone now. It's just one of those basically blood pumps. So your blood's still flowing, but no longer is being pumped. It's just cycled through. So in turn, you have no pulse at that point.
Right.
But the blood's still cycling.
Just, was he just one long beat?
Is he one of the heads on Futurama?
He
should be.
Now.
Papa Roach was one of those concerts where I'm like, I like the album Infest, but anything like that, I Tear My Heart Open, like the lovey dovey Papa Roach shit, yeah. I could leave not
Scars.
Take.
Scars.
I actually hate that song.
I actually have a really big problem with Papa Roach, to be honest.
Oh.
Almost irrationally.
All right. Well, what is it? Is it the name?
Every single...
Well, is it for the insect or for the spent blunt?
Yeah, never mind my Florida roach phobia, but they always have a line somewhere in the song, and it's usually a pretty... How do I want to say it? A pretty important line that doesn't rhyme. It fucking kills me.
Are you a man who needs symmetry and right? So
sometimes I
know what you're getting at.
Yeah.
So if you're gonna say a word,
he really wants a McLaren F1.
Why?
Driving wheel. The steering wheel's in the middle.
That is true.
Oh, middle'd be perfect.
It would be. It's the perfect driving position.
Beautiful. Yeah.
If you're gonna say a word with the intention of rhyming, it should rhyme.
Yes.
If you're not,
so they bastardize a word in order to try to get it to rhyme. And I think that's what bothers me.
Hip hop kind of does that.
Yeah, that's totally school rap.
Although, there's a guy named Watsky who's fucking great. He's been on some of the epic rap battles of history. And he has a fucking greatest line in one of his songs. He says, I go to Miley's house. I see that Miley's home. I play Miley's rib cage with my dick like it's a xylophone.
See, now that I can get behind. Yeah. Oh, I'm okay with that. I'm okay with a little bit of flex. What do they call it? A little flex.
Yeah,
flexibility.
Yeah,
fan fucking tastic line.
Let's see. To me, that's at least creative.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly. Well, last night, 3 Days Grace put on, like I said, Matt, but he's put a lot more effort into the, because Adam had the grit to his voice.
Yes.
And Matt Walsh did not. He's worked on that, and actually, it fits the music a lot better.
Okay. I was going to ask, is he trying to sound like Adam?
No. Or, no, okay. And that's good. That's good. You don't want the cover.
I agree.
You don't want the cover. You'll just go see the tribute band if that's right. Going to be the case.
We just saw Blink. Blink was in town a couple weeks ago, and you know, obviously Tom's not there anymore, and they got this new guy. And I forget where he's from. You probably remember.
Oh God, I've seen this. I can't remember his name.
But anyway, you know, they're doing a lot of their. So this was like the 20th anniversary of Enema of the State. So they played the album.
Yeah, exactly. Shit, that in high school.
So that was their concert. It was essentially they played that. That album from beginning to end was how they started there before they got to any of their new stuff.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I kind of feel bad for the new guy because number one, he's not Tom. He's not going to sound like Tom. He's not going to sing like Tom, and he's singing all of Tom's songs.
Yeah,
right?
Nobody sounds like Tom.
Right. So you could tell he was very focused on, let me play the guitar and sing the lyrics. So you kind of missed a little bit of his personality. And then once they came into their new stuff, he actually kind of blossomed, I guess.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
And it was great. It was a great concert.
Have you seen Alice in Chains? No. It's brilliant. William Duvall is... I'm such a big William Duvall fan because he does those old songs such good justice. He does such a great...
I mean, that's got to be hard shoes to fill, right?
Yeah. But the thing is, Duvall's the better musician.
Really?
Lane...
Well, Lane wasn't really a musician, was
he? No, he just sang.
He was just a lyricist.
He only wrote the words... To Angry Chair,
Nutshell,
right? I think he wrote the words to Nutshell.
I thought so too.
But pretty much all the music was written by Cantrell.
Yeah,
but Angry Chair, he wrote the music and the words too. Lane Staley did, and then Hate to Feel was Lane Staley. That's okay. most of it was Jerry, and I tell people, I'm like, look. Lane's not coming back, and if William Duvall's good enough for Jerry Cantrell, damn it, he should be good enough for you too. And
yeah, the guy, I mean, whatever gets Jerry Cantrell to continue to make music,
mm-hmm. and William plays somebody. Guitar great, that's great it. Guitar player, yeah, oh yeah.
Which depot do you like to shop at? Home Depot, Office Depot, or Boggy Depot?
Boggy Depot's a great fucking CD. Jerry Cantrell's solo stuff. Have you listened to it?
No,
it's great.
He's good.
Is it
Anger Rising? Cut You In, My Song. God, those are all good. It's real, but it sounds. It sounds like Alice in Chains.
Well, also
I need to go
the
tumble
Lane
down
Staley
that
solo effort.
Mad Season,
that. Like, I was thinking like November Hotel, like that band. Yeah,
that was a dark. Mad Season was a dark.
River of Deceit. Still one of my favorites.
One of my favorites to play.
When you hear those words, same with Nutshell. Mm-hmm. You know, it's those. If you look at the actual lyrics, it's only like 8 sentences.
Yeah,
but the amount of I don't know, meaning that they've been able to pack into this. I mean, just a terribly dark, mm-hmm. powerful song.
That one's great. I like a Long Gone Day on Mad Season. You remember, you know that one. Do you know that one?
I don't.
You have the CD though, don't you? Like, yeah. Or the album CD. I'm so fucking old.
I can stream it.
Yeah. is it Mark?
I'm sure it's on Apple Music somewhere.
If you want the CD, I can get you the CD.
It's Mark.
I just need to check my garage.
Was it from Mudhoney? I think, or.
Touch You, You're Sick?
It's so much blood, I'm starting to drown and runs from cold. It's like one of the, that Long Gone Day, but that's a great, because Lane comes over the top in that high.
Oh, yeah.
But I wish I would have got to see Lane in concert, though. But Alice in Chains puts on a great show now. And Soundgarden was a great show. Nine Inch Nails was a great
show. That was a really fun
show.
Concert.
You seen Nine Inch Nails live?
I have not.
Summer of 14, that was the... Shut Up and Play the Hits tour for both Nine Inch Nails and Soundgarden. Yeah. So it was all the early 90s catalog.
Oh, man.
And Nine Inch Nails had redone a lot of the songs off Pretty Hate Machine and Downward Spiral. Yeah. It just incredible.
Chimera was horrible. They were horrible live. Killswitch Engage awesome.
That's funny you mentioned Chimera because that was going to be my go-to
for bad.
Favorite concert.
Oh.
Well, because they opened for... Fear Factory and Slipknot.
That's right.
And so that's my go-to. Winston-Salem, spring of 04. Oh, man, that show was so much fun. Like, held at the depot in Winston-Salem. So it was this older than dirt train depot in downtown Winston.
Jesus.
And, you know, Chimera, didn't want to be there, didn't want to do anything. Like, oh, it's like, your song is We Hate Everyone. No kidding.
Yeah, that
you sound the part.
They ended with that, and their drummer was playing the whole time. They would zoom in, he just looked like this, and then like when they did their epic, you know, thank you and everything, he like threw his drumsticks off and just walked off the fucking stage. Like, okay, you don't want to be here. I'll go fill in for you. I'll go get paid what you fucking get paid to do this shit, man. but no, I saw Chimera with it was Lacuna Coil opened, which was great, by the way. Not just her looks, but she's married to Jim Root from Slipknot, but did you know that?
I did not know that.
She's 5'2", he's 6'7". Like, Jim Root looks like a fucking goddamn goblin up there on the stage with his crazy Joker mask. Yeah. And he's 6'7", his hair is all... Holy cow. but it was them, Chimera, and then Disturbed, and then Killswitch Engage closed it out. Killswitch Engage, and then Disturbed headline. And Disturbed was boring live.
You know, I've seen them live, and... And I am a Disturbed fan.
That'd be a lot to keep up with night after night.
Yeah,
it was just David Draymond has I like Disturbed, but yeah. All he did was walk around the stage.
That's literally all he does.
And he doesn't. Yep. There's no theater. There's nothing.
Nothing. Yeah.
Oh, hi, American Hi-Fi. Remember them? Really.
Basically,
like one of the weenie roasts that was just uninspired.
That's just like you have to Killswitch was just back and forth because that was when Howard played with them. And I'm a Howard. I'm more of a Howard than a Jesse guy. But no, they were all over the fun. That was just a great, great, great show. I just like get into it. Like, pretend like you're enjoying it.
Right. And if you spend too much energy trying to sound like your album, then you miss a lot of that. And I think that might be one of
And it's always going to sound Draymond's different like, live.
Right. And that's good. Mm-hmm. That's what we want, right?
Well, yeah. And like. I always like when I did the album. I always wanted to write like stuff that I could play live with a band, not stuff that you have to layer and layer and layer and like.
Right.
But
to the point where you can't even play it live, right?
Correct. Yeah. So
like Chris Hardwick's band, Radiohead, it's nice. Them speeding up like 20 Radiohead songs in one song, but realize he can't do this live. There's so much going on with Radiohead. But that's like the band is Hard and Firm because it's Chris Hardwick and Mike Furman doing 20 Radiohead songs in the span of 5 minutes. It's like,
Jesus Christ.
I'm not a Radiohead fan, but this song's incredible. Yeah. And of course, it's like very bluegrassy.
I like High and Dry and Karma Police and Creep. I'll listen to just out of nostalgia. But
I really like Paranoid Android.
Paranoid Android's good too.
Creep I aced on Guitar Rock Hero Band on vocals.
I've never played that.
Oh, that's right. You told me that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm not opposed to it. I'm not an elitist. I've just never played it.
it's a ton of fun.
It kind of looks like.
For all of us fake musicians.
I'd rather pretend to sing. Like, I can't keep up with the button pushing.
I was going to say, it kind of looks like Simon.
Yeah.
It is.
Finger Simon.
It is.
Sorry, Jansons.
Heyo.
Didn't mean that. Just trying to think of other disappointing concerts. Bush was pretty disappointing. When Chevelle and Bush played, Chevelle opened for Bush. Chevelle was great. And then Bush was like... The decibels were just like 20 less. It was just.
I just see Bush. That's so one of those bands I just never.
So I'm guessing Chevelle. Did
I hear Glycerine
not
one more time.
So I'm guessing Chevelle didn't do the cover I was hoping for from the cover to Dead Milkman's Mission Camaro.
No. Well, Breaking Benjamin played a lot of covers. They played the Imperial Death March last night.
Nice.
They played that. And then went into.
No words to that one.
They did Smells Like Teen Spirit. Cowboys from Hell.
What?
Inner Sandman. They had a montage
That's incredible.
And then Bulls on Parade.
Oh, nice.
They had a montage of like standard tuning stuff.
Yeah. How was their live show? Were they good?
It was good. It was good. The thing is, it furthered my bias against open air festivals. I would much rather be at an indoor venue just because the sound is that much better. Emily and I were
it just disappears and you don't.
Yeah, we were in row O.
And
there.
It's also high as balls too, and that's not your thing.
No, well, we were in row O.
Fillmore.
Oh, it's great, Fillmore.
Oh, I love the Fillmore.
We're row O, and so we're pretty close.
That's
to
close.
The fucking
Those
stage.
Are good seats. Yeah.
I could have a conversation with Emily, talking to her like this, and not raising.
And you guys
levels.
Had seats, so the lawn seats. People. Oh man.
And I was just like, really? Like,
yeah, I think my last
concert. Every band, Chevelle was the loudest band, which is weirdest because they were the 3-piece band, and Breaking Benjamin was a 5-piece band. Now.
And you said that a lot about them, that for a 3-piece, those guys put out.
I think my last concert at Blockbuster, Verizon, PNC, whatever that one by UNC Charlotte is, was Van Halen with Kenny Wayne Shepherd opening. And that was 4 years ago on the Groupon tour.
Nice.
It had DLR. So I can say I've seen him. And I don't know, well, he was this big on stage, but somewhere along the way, he had more costume changes than Cher did. We're just peeling this off along the way, man.
Oh, yeah. Did you see the meme? It said, back when I was growing up, there were, gender was well defined, and it had a picture of Prince, and then all the heavy metal, the 80s metal
and
guys.
And Grace Jones.
And Grace Jones. Yeah. I don't think that was ever a thing.
No. Super feminist.
I think just people just did whatever they wanted to do back in the day.
No one gave a shit.
Exactly. And which is what we should all do now. Well, of course. Just not give a shit.
Yeah. Especially if you're creating and making music, no one gives a shit.
Yeah,
Prince was the only guy that could dress better than your girl and then still take her home after the show. Even though Steve's not a big, I'm a big Prince. I love
Prince. Bowie's demise.
I love Prince and he doesn't, but then he loves Mike Patton, and I don't.
Who's Mike Patton?
The dude from Faith No More.
Faith No More.
Oh no shit.
There's a zillion other bands that he does too.
Mr. Bungle, which is doing a reunion tour.
Yeah, it's like if. It better just be California. The rest of Bungle's pretty fucking strange, but kindly.
So,
although The Girls of Porn is an awesome song.
So here's an interesting tour that's going on this fall. Slayer and Primus.
Now
what?
Yes.
Primus would be.
That's
real funny. Primus. Les Claypool is now touring with Sean Lennon, son of John.
Yep.
With his. Trippy dippy awesomeness.
Does he make good music?
Yeah.
Oh yeah.
The Lennon Claypool Delirium. He sounds just like John on the songs. Yep. It's really? Incredible.
Yep. So it's John Lennon, Les Claypool.
And it was the magic of having the cover Data Center at work. And SoundCloud's the one music streaming site I can get to work there. So, oddly enough, have it on Nine Inch Nails Ghost Station. So the instrumental Nine Inch Nails. This pops up. That's amazing.
Nice.
So, and then whatever else is on that station was awesome too. So, SoundCloud, the running gag is just for rappers, but whatever else is on there is kind of amazing.
Can you mumble
if you know what you're not looking for?
So, what is everyone's favorite Primus song?
I didn't get that my
I still
I didn't get that my concert yet.
We're known as Big Brother.
God damn it! Sorry, Steve.
Chimera opening for the. Slipknot and Fear Factory.
Oh, right.
Yeah, so I did say that. I can't remember anything. Anyway, his beer's working.
Maybe most disappointing concert,
at least
one you didn't expect,
or another good one.
Yeah, one you didn't expect to like as much as you did. Because mine was last night with 3 Days Grace. I was like, I like some of their music, but I was like,
you're like, sure, I'm going to see Chevelle. They're playing whatever.
I'm a big Breaking Benjamin fan too. But I was like, damn, 3 Days Grace, fucking. Right. Although I will say, before you get started. 3 Days Grace, Matt Walsh did the biggest fucking faux pas you ever do as a rock band playing live. You're going to have to... I
don't know it.
Don't know it?
Play with nothing but your hits?
He wore his own band's t-shirt on stage.
Oh, no.
That is so that is so masturbatory.
Man.
It fucking hurt.
Number one fan up there.
And
huh?
I told Emily, I was like, do you see that? And she's like,
I
don't see what the big
goer faux pas.
She's like, I don't see what the big deal is. And then another Luke, the from CAA, from the Charlotte Atheist Agnostic, who has the redheaded wife. You might have seen him before. He had seats right beside me. Like
nice.
They had seats right, and and they showed up a little late, and they were rocking out, and he's like, AJ. I was like, what? He goes, he's fucking wearing his own band shirt. It's like, he's like, what a fucking douche. I was like, thank you. Thank you. You're not supposed to do that.
And that's why I crossed genres when I went to Grunge Fest 2 years ago. I wore a Dead Kennedy shirt to it.
Nice.
So I had the same genre. It's like, those in the know, they know what's up.
And I told Emily, I was like, see there, that is so raw. And then his wife was like, yeah, you don't fucking do that. I was like, of course you don't fucking do
that. You don't do that. You don't do that as a fan. You especially don't do that as a musician.
That is the most self-congratulatory fucking hoolie I've ever seen in my life.
What if the shirt was a bootleg, though? Stick it to yourself.
We're back to masturbatory.
It's full circle. First of all.
That was very, very low. So, Steve, is there any other concerts you didn't think you would enjoy that you actually did?
think in my limited concert going, I've been mostly impressed, except for like some of the acts at Weenie Roast, like American Hi-Fi, just not bothering. And hey, no one hears from them anymore.
Hey, well, you know.
Well, even Nickelback 4 days after 9/11 was entertaining. Of course, that was before they became their own, you know, laughingstock. Like, people trying to mosh, and like Chad's like, hey man, like, gotta be careful. This pavement's gonna win.
Jeez.
Well,
it's like, no shit.
Their first two albums were good.
And then we saw an airplane flying over like we'd never seen one before. Yeah,
Their first two albums were pretty good, but then it gets formulaic.
Yeah, and then it's just
it gets
same
formulaic.
Game.
Well, the problem too is if you put out the same album all the time, people tell you you're not taking risks. And then if you go full Neil Young and you put every album as a different genre, then you alienate fans. So the moral of the story
is... Bob Dylan went electric. How dare he in 1965?
Yeah. Really? Just make whatever music
just
you
want. Just do whatever you want, man.
Exactly.
You can't please everybody.
And exactly.
And you got a hand to Patton for that one. That sure. He's been everywhere, man.
Just, do what you... I mean, it's the same way people don't like Chevelle because, he just tries to sound like Tool. No, he doesn't. He sounds like he sounds.
I don't think he's...
Well, they say he has that tone, but like
I thought it was more a perfect circle myself.
You can't help how you sound, like
right. He's not trying to sound
when I
like
first
Orky,
started. No, when I first
just,
started singing,
if he just does,
I would emulate my heroes.
Sure,
there are parts of songs that I kind of try. Like, I do kind of like Cornelian and
sure,
and like Jerry Cantrell, because I mean those are the guys. But after a while, you find your own
why
voice.
Everything I do sounds like Axl Rose. Like, anytime AJ was playing Four Non Blondes, I try to morph that into Axl Rose-ish. I said, hey, yeah, 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 hey, yeah, yeah. I said, hey, what's going on?
But you sound like you sound. You can't make your, I mean, it's obvious when you try to make yourself sound like somebody
else. I think
else.
As someone that tries to sing, because I do. I don't do it in public.
You know, I sing like an amputee.
Yeah, but I
can't hold a note, can't carry a tune. Thanks, Bloodhound Gang.
Nice.
Damn.
That's just from 95. Carry on.
No, but trying to find your own voice, I think, has to be incredibly tough because you're so influenced by all these different people. So if I sing a Pearl Jam song, I want to try to sound like Vedder because that's how he sang it.
Mm-hmm.
If I sing a Soundgarden song, I want to sound like Cornell because that's how I know.
Yeah, exactly.
But that's what you know. So you can't hit the note, but you try to hit the note.
Yeah.
You know, but you got to, you know, so how does AJ sing it or how does Bryan sing it? Like, I don't even know.
Yeah, right?
I mean, it's a hard thing to.
Well, the thing is, like, when you're finding your own voice, like, you have to. I've had training too, which I finally took it like 2 years ago, and I'm glad I did. But
it drove you nuts.
Yeah. Well, you sure. Find you do find your own voice. Well, I went to a classically trained, like, so rock music most of the time is not classically trained. So like he would get on to me about scooping. So there would be song I would be carrying my notes, and then he would hit the C sharp, and I would scoop up to it, and he's like, no, just hit the C sharp. You don't have to scoop up to the note. But then
when you explain it, I know exactly what you're talking.
Yeah,
about.
And yeah, and a lot of musicians. A lot of people do that without even knowing it, but it's in a lot of, it's just how, but that's rock is not perfect. Whereas
right.
I was taking lessons from a classically trained musician who is fluent in five languages. So he knows.
So it's a little more, it's technical, right?
Yeah. Versus, and I'm glad I did it. It helped me so much. Like I would get done with a show and I'd be hoarse or, you know, I can get done playing a 3 hour show and just have a normal conversation. And it's pacing, it's timing. The one thing he got me, and this will help you if you really like, kind of wanted to casually be a better singer, is he would say, you know, hit this and I'll hit the octave of it. And I would go up, and he said, why did you get louder? He said, I just told you to hit the higher note. I didn't tell you to sing it louder.
That's me. For me to hit certain notes, I have to get very loud.
Yeah. And it's not supposed, and it, you have to train your body. I mean, singing is harder than playing guitar, bar none, all day long.
Really?
All fucking day. Yeah. There's only so many different ways you can play that guitar.
Sure.
And get sound out of it. There's a million different ways to sing, and a lot of them are not correct. Which is why a lot of your bands you see, especially a lot of your 80s bands from the hair metal days that you hear now sing, and they sound horrible. Molly Crue. So,
yeah.
Because I like the Crue.
Or Meatloaf has Trash's voice.
Yeah. And even in pseudo-modern metal, like, I love Mudvayne. I fucking love Mudvayne. Chad Gray sounds horrible. And the guy.
What's his new band? Hell yeah!
Just a fucking stupid fucking band.
It's like Pantera Junior.
Goddamn, it's a stupid fucking band. That's so. That's like that's bro metal to me.
It
like,
is bro metal.
If you name your
band, he went from Mudvayne. He in Mudvayne is one of those. They were kind of in the neighborhood for me of Slipknot, where they were when you first start to go down the path of a heavier metal. You know, Slipknot and Mudvayne. That was your most commercial. You know, before you start getting like thrasher metal, right? Which I don't like thrasher metal.
Yeah, I saw Mudvayne with 9 Point years ago with a German Exchange. 9 Point, dude,
I love 9 Point.
He was upset the concert wasn't hard enough.
Really?
Because like, this guy's been devakin, that's why.
Oh, man. Yeah, so you go to that and...
I mean, 9 Point, since you brought up the name, I want to comment on 9 Point because it's probably one of the more underrated bands that you never hear.
Yeah, like I know they had a cover that went on the Miami Vice soundtrack, and that was all I'd heard of them prior to that show.
The like only Air of the Night, the
only song I've heard by 9 Point is Bullet with a Name on it.
That's all you've heard?
That's all I've heard.
Would you
do
like
me
a
favor?
Tumble down
that rabbit hole. Okay. I've seen them live; they are fucking fantastic.
Okay,
I'll be right back, y'all, and then I'll bring you some Hot Bullets if your name's on them.
Yes, please.
Sweet. That's the only song I've heard. And
oh, 9 Point's so good.
Okay, that's good to know. I'm always like on the hunt. To hear new stuff, but then I'm just going to be in a rabbit hole. But I told Emily last night what happens every time I go to a concert is that I get super motivated to write new material, and that's exactly what fucking happened.
Oh, see, that's awesome. I don't have that creative bone, so I'm jealous of the people that have it.
Well,
I just don't have it.
I haven't figured me out. I am so weird, and I'll explain that because I majored in math.
Okay, so you have kind of a beautiful
but I'm
mind
a naturally logical person. Which is way different than a typical musician where they're super creative and it's like the right versus left brain, where I'm super logical about things, but then I'm also like really creative about things. So that's why I like to do so. Like, I love to play. How much fun is this, by the way?
You know what? I'm having a great time. I love it.
This is why this is episode number 40. like we've done 40 of these and it never gets old. Like, some episodes are more fun than others, but like, there's always new topics. It's an endless amount of beer topics, endless amount of music. Like, we did One Hit Wonders 2 episodes ago, which was hilarious. And like cover songs, which a lot of songs we didn't even know were covers.
Yeah.
By the way, I had to have a serious conversation with a customer of mine that the Righteous Brothers were not black. They're white. They're two white guys. How could you not know this in the age of Google and knowing pretty much anything? A customer of ours didn't know that the Righteous Brothers were white.
To be honest, I might not have known that.
Really?
I'm dead serious.
Two white guys. Nerdy-looking white guys, too.
Really?
Yeah. Very nerdy-looking white guys. A lot of soul, though.
My fault. I think I just assumed.
You hear them say, you just automatically assume.
Yeah.
You just automatically assume.
Fair enough.
We got Hot Bullets. Dippas.
Thank you.
Slightly less warm.
But now that I've done this and kind of... pop my cherry of podcasting. I mean, this isn't really that stressful. So even if it's a Tuesday, I could probably, if I get out of work in time.
That's fine. Yeah.
That's always my caveat.
Yeah, that's fine. It's a breeze. We just start wherever you got here. Okay. So the episodes with guests usually run way long. And then the ones with us are anywhere from like an hour and a half to 2 hours and 15 minutes. The longest we did was over 3 hours, and that was with two guests. Nice. But that was the first one we had guests with. So, but it's easy to do because this is just like normally what we would do if we hung out anyway. And now we're just recording it. So of course you can do it for 2 hours. It's hard. Yeah. It's an hour and a half already.
Is it really?
Yeah, hour and a half.
I mean, I've had people over at my house, and we'll open beers, and we'll just bullshit. And next thing you know, it's 3 a.m.
Yeah.
Oh, you know what I mean? So it just happens naturally.
And believe it or not, even after 40 episodes, we're already creeping up on 1,000 downloads.
Ooh.
Can you believe that?
Congratulations.
That's not bad.
Yeah.
Everybody's got to start somewhere, man.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
So Steve brought the Sierra Nevada Hot Bullet Double IPA from California or Mills River, North Carolina. Cheers, guys.
It's just from Costco. It's 27 for a 24-pack of mixed bag Sierra Nevadas and everything's good. This one's the best.
That's a smooth dipper.
I mean, to be honest, we talked about my car history. My beer history is way more extensive.
It's a good thing those don't go hand in hand.
Yeah.
I could not go through that list.
So what do you do Mondays, Brian?
Drink beer.
So do we.
You go to pour on Monday, don't you? Or do you just...
I actually don't.
Oh.
Monday, I try not to drink Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
Oh, yeah, we don't do that. We got
Thursday, I usually fail on Thursday.
I drink every day, but I try not to.
I used to, yeah.
Well.
Mine's a weight issue. I had a very extensive beer hobby.
It's
do you
easy
enjoy
to do.
Baby carrots? That's been my secret weapon. His, and also having two jobs keep me on my feet.
Yeah, and my job so keeps me on my feet.
See, mine's the opposite. I have a very sedentary job.
Yeah, I couldn't do it. Well, yeah. And one of my other jobs pays me to drink. So
that's not so bad.
But you've been to Flying Saucer though, haven't you?
Yes.
All right. Yeah. Love so that place. Those are all 200 beers. Each plate represents 200.
Holy cow.
Yeah, Steve's done it more than I have.
I'm creeping up on my 15th.
And I'm creeping up on number 10.
But
and those are all unique, right?
Well, each 200 is unique, mm-hmm. but you know, after that length of time, they've swapped beers out. So if you were to somehow drink the same 200 beers in a row, A, you need to do that quickly, because B, they cycle it out quickly enough, mm-hmm. Since... You know, a lot of breweries will be very prolific in releasing random stuff.
Yeah.
Also offering an accidental threat to the craft beer industry of trying too many exciting new things. Though, Noda's got a new one every week.
Yes.
You're never going to Pokemon that one.
No.
Got to drink them all? Well, try to anyway.
Yep. So they reset.
I tried very much, and I realized I was beaten.
They reset your plate. Or they reset your every plate. They reset your number, and then you can just drink. You could drink the same 200 in the same order if you really wanted to.
Yeah, but
for that,
you're not a psycho.
Exactly. Yeah. So, but after 10, they send you to the Great American Beer Festival for free.
And it used to be you plus guests. Now it'll just be him going next year.
Probably next year.
Night.
Are you going?
Oh, so they're paying for it.
Yeah, that's how.
So
I
you
was
got
in
it. You're going
four
for
years
sure.
Ago.
Yeah. Once you hit plate number 10, they send you the paperwork and pay for you to go.
Okay, that's fantastic.
That covers
because
flight and entry. You're on your own for hotel.
Yeah.
So, but
still,
that means
easy,
you
easy.
Tell them when you're going in, tell them you're leaving. You're on your own for hotel. The Homewood Suites downtown. That was a nice hotel.
Yeah. Absolutely.
I've never been to Denver either.
Night.
So
you've never been.
I've never been to Denver.
Yeah, I was like, if I go back, I'm never returning here.
You know what? I get it. After being out there, I get it. I've been out there twice
it's,
now.
You mm-hmm. know, it's a lot of fun, and it seems to have its shit together.
It really does.
Mm-hmm.
We went out there for GABF. It's kind of by accident. We went out there last October for our 4-year anniversary. Me and my wife. My wife drinks as much beer as me.
Champion.
And so we went out there. We're like, you know, where do you want to go for the, you know, somewhere we've never been? She said, how about Denver? I'm like, okay, great.
Right up Highway 16, y'all.
From Charlotte. Not that Denver. But, you know, Denver to Charlotte is about a $250 flight direct.
Yeah, and
it's super
it's 3
easy.
Hours.
Yeah.
It's a very
easy.
Quick 1,500 miles.
It really is. Yeah, it really is. And
Vegas, I was there a month ago, and that was a 5-hour flight.
Which doesn't make sense to me, but
yeah,
maybe instead of flying with the maybe they do the opposite thing and they just go the long way around. Like you flew over Cancun to get there.
Yeah,
there's Mexico. Where the fuck are you taking me?
I didn't know so many crop circles on the way to Denver.
Yeah, Denver was. We went and saw Weezer at Red Rocks.
Oh hell yeah!
Oh wow!
And again, this was all we were planning the trip anyway.
Elmer bust.
Yeah. Nice. We planned the trip anyway, and it was like, oh, let's see what's going on at Red Rocks, and it was Weezer. I'm like,
jeez.
Well, fuck yeah, we'll go do that. And then GABF was just an absolute shit show, so it was so much fun.
It is so big that you would need to go to multiple sessions to really explore it, and it was overwhelming.
How many days?
It really was.
How many days is it?
I think it's 3 days and like a afternoon and evening session of each.
Two sessions a day, I think, is right.
And they'll send you to a session, and they'll give you a roadmap, but it's simply going to be impossible to catch
everything to one,
in a 3 or 4 hour session.
Yeah. I mean, there's over like 3,000 samples or something.
Have you ever been to a beer festival, AJ? Ungodly number.
No.
Because you keep lamenting, like, I couldn't drink $40 worth of beer in X amount of time. Like, well, try to. Yeah. You know, go see you do a thing. Like, Charlotte Oktoberfest proper has been kiboshed because they couldn't secure a venue,
mm-hmm.
but there are other beer festivals that happen to be also named Oktoberfest coming up. So
I kind of want to do it indoors.
There was the one There was the one at the Fillmore a couple years ago that was a craft beer and Girl Scout cookie pairing.
Fuck
to
yes.
give me the strange.
That's fantastic.
Dude, that gave me the weirdest buzz ever, having a sugar high and being drunk. I was like, man, I didn't sleep for days after that one.
It's like, even in my dreams, I was wired.
Yeah.
Seriously.
Yes.
Oh, man.
Oh, Jesus. I want to go. I don't want to go and be like, I always have this like, I don't know whether it's correct or not, but being in an outdoor festival, being like in some shitty, dirty, like mud everywhere and just standing in line for beer and it being hot and being miserable.
There have been some that have been over pavement, like the one in Atlanta I've been to a bunch.
Mm-hmm.
That's all paved.
That's Decatur, right?
Yeah. And also being in mid-October, the temperature's nice.
Fair.
And it's walking distance from Hagen's house. Now it's a little further out and I was about to pass out afterwards, but I made it through.
Atlanta's
a concrete jungle. I don't
know how,
but I made it through. Yeah. Oh, hi here.
It's getting there, isn't it? Mm-hmm. It's slowly getting there. Now, how far you were in Jacksonville, right?
That's where I was before I moved to Charlotte, but I grew up Tampa, Sarasota, Bradenton area. So
gotcha. You're a Marine? Oh wait, that's this state, Jacksonville.
Trust me. I mean, Jacksonville, Florida has a lot of naval and reserves
buddy mine
and stuff. So.
Was doubly stationed there, and now is returning to Corpus Christi. Like, could you not stay in Jacksonville? Like,
Jacksonville's actually, pretty. Like, it's very pretty.
Dude, I think it's very underrated.
I actually really
like Jacksonville.
Do not care for 95 through there. Like, I will take the loop, like, just go over all the bridges to not have to drive through that downtown part where I feel like, well, here's a giant wall here I'm going to crash into.
Yeah. And if you have time, take the loop the other way
and
head out towards the beaches and take the long way. There's some good breweries out there.
We did the loop on the way down.
It's the closer side of Florida, so it's what?
It's 399 miles.
Okay.
From here.
And Savannah was 280. I went there a year ago.
Savannah's about the middle point between Jacksonville.
I love Savannah, too.
I've never been.
Savannah is what New Orleans is, except it's closer, it's cheaper, and it's cleaner.
You had me a cleaner.
God damn, dude. I'm still hating on New Orleans, and I know people love New Orleans, but I didn't have that much fun there.
You know what?
You should have gone sooner.
I went for my anniversary.
You should have gone single.
I knew I should have gone when I was at. So I went to school at FSU, which, you know, New Orleans is only about a 6-hour drive. And mm-hmm. one year we made the Sugar Bowl. It was in New Orleans.
One of those drinking schools with a football problem, right?
Yeah, seriously. It was. I barely remember that
shit. The old Bert Kreischer was there. I mean,
yeah. Uh-huh. Yeah. But I made the mistake of not going, and I wish I had, because that would have been a really, really fun trip.
Right down I-10.
Yeah.
Every
four
time.
4 hours from Tallahassee?
Is it
3 hours,
I think, it's
from Pensacola?
4 to 6 hours, I think. But
every time we went down Bourbon Street, there people were trying to shine your shoes for $20. Like every
See,
time.
I don't like that. To me, that just annoys the shit out of me.
Every single time. Once you stepped on Bourbon Street, or where we were adjacent, so we stayed at the Dauphine. So there's Dauphine Street and I think Market Street, but then Bourbon Street. Every time you stepped on, it's like, hey, let me shine your shoes. God damn it, leave me the fuck alone.
Constantly being hustled. I don't like that.
Don't wear shinable shoes.
I wasn't. They were non-shinable shoes. That'd be a great band name.
Non-shinable shoes, I like it.
Jesus Christ. Now, the food was good. And then, like, Emily wanted to take me to...
And so is Razoo's.
Exactly. But the thing, like... The food was good, but wasn't worth the money. And then everybody goes for the beignets.
Yep.
And we went to Café du Monde, which is like the world famous beignets.
Sure.
And it was a fucking funnel cake. That's what a beignet is.
I mean, if I can be honest, are beignets really that hard to make?
No, they're fucking not. It's the novelty. It's like going to the when we were in Chicago, we didn't go, but like that cheeseburger place where the guy yells cheeseburger, like
made famous from a 1970s SNL skit.
And then they give you a shitty burger, and you're like, thanks.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, thanks.
Pepsi that was Coke. Like, well, second mistake.
that was worth the hour wait to get into this fucking shithole.
I'll actually be in Chicago in October, so.
Luminati's was a great
been there.
Pizza
that's
place.
Fantastic.
Yeah, that's a great place.
Pizza or Stromboli?
Yes. I like deep dish anyway. I like a lot of sauce.
I do too.
I don't want to pick my pizza up and then it hit me in the elbow with grease and cheese.
I'm okay eating pizza with a fork and a knife.
Fair, yeah. But preference, I like a lot of salt. I like the sauce.
Four and a half, I like the sauce. Just content with the Costco snack bar pizza. $2 for a giant slice? Yeah, that'll do.
Well,
is it the best? No, but the price is right.
The theory, the solution is to take your foldable slice and then just have a bowl of like seasoned marinara sauce.
Yeah.
And just scoop
there you
it.
Go.
Now that's really what that's going to call the happy heart attack.
Yeah, fuck you, heart. The heart is evil and should be punished like the liver. that was Goose Island was great, even though there's no to-go. You had to go to the other location to get the to-go stuff, but fantastic.
Are either on an island?
No.
Oh, so it's just
maybe
like
an island of safety?
So it's like the conundrum that I'm encountering next week going to Rhode Island. Neither a road nor an island discuss.
Yep.
Why the hell are you going to Rhode Island?
Fiance's brother lives up that way. So never been there.
Driving?
No. Flying. Flights for the both of us were cheaper than my flight to Vegas was.
Who's dropping you off?
I think we're just going to take your car in.
Okay, fair enough. How many days?
We're running out of time to extend the flight, I'm afraid. So I think it's going to be Saturday to Wednesday.
Okay, that's why we're doing it on Sunday. We just did this on Tuesday.
Otherwise, the cycle would have been.
I thought it was all about my car. So
yeah, it's multi-purpose.
Well, look, it was a multi. It was like, well, I told Steve last episode. I was like, I don't want to wait 3 weeks to do an episode. He's like, yeah, I don't either. I'm like, let's do it Sunday. And then this morning, I was like, well, we're doing it on a Sunday, and Brian just got a new car, and it's Sunday, and I don't think he's busy. Brian,
believe it or not, I don't work on Sundays.
Nice. Yeah. It may be busy, but you write the schedule, dude.
Fair enough, but we rotate weekend because I want to be a good boss, and I want to be like fair to everybody because I've worked for a lot of turbo douches over the years who would take every weekend off, and now I'm like, no.
You
don't
want to be that guy.
I'm rotating.
Good for you, man.
Those are the best Mercedes.
Honestly, I mean that sincerely.
You're only as good as your worst employee. Yeah. And like not worried, but your slowest or you know your newest employee and like
if that's the case, print shop's fucked.
Yeah, I have a director and I won't get into any details. So
nobody knows. So
okay,
does he have one of those folding chairs? What do you mean wrong director?
I wish
I've got one
a managing director. I have two in my group. One of them is fantastic. He's my mentor. I love him. I'd kill somebody for this guy. The other one, she is going to kill. She is just absolutely, yeah. hopefully her name is the one that comes up. She's the most ineffective leader I've ever worked for in my life. And because it's, you know, somewhat corporate, I got to just bite my tongue and just do my work. But, man, it makes it brutal. It makes a hard job even tougher. So, good for you for taking care of your...
I try. Yeah. But then we have this one employee who has no position of power at all. Who thinks she does and wants to get in everybody's business. And then one day I'm just going to go full Cheryl Tunt from Archer. You're not my supervisor.
Did you ever play the Flash game that was titled themed for Archer where you're playing the part of Cheryl and you're setting fire to the office.
And then it just bothers me. I want to go like, oh, are you my boss? Yeah. No.
What's your name again?
What's your name? Who are you?
What's your name again? What's your name again?
There he goes again.
Since we have cats, you know, we know the squirt bottle.
Yep.
Yeah. You should just carry one of those around. Spray in their face.
No. Like,
no. Oh. No.
That's probably your funniest t-shirt.
Okay, it kind of is, actually. Oh, Jesus Christ. But no, you got to be fair to your people because they'll be more loyal. Like,
yeah.
I gave my newest employee, he had 3 days off in a row. I was like, hey, how was your weekend? He's like, that was good. I was kind of ready to come back. That's what I want to hear.
That's fantastic.
I was ready to come back to work.
And that reflects directly on you. That's good.
I don't want to toot my, but I was like, you know, how did I've worked with some shitty people. And it's like, how horrible did that feel? So
it consumes your entire day.
I don't ever want anybody to feel like that. Like they got it made. Like they'll go to another store to help out and they'll come back and go, Jesus Christ, I'm so fucking glad I work in this place. Like see there. And I know I can't pay them as well as I want to because it's all corporate, but people who feel appreciated will always do more than expected.
They sure will.
They sure will.
Yep.
Cheers to that.
Absolutely.
And I'm still looking to get out and do something entertaining. Yeah. Steve and I are going to think about doing voice acting. Nice. Get into. Oh, you hit my power glove.
Oh, my God.
Oh, no.
Did you not even notice that?
I just elbowed 1982 over here. What
you
is
did.
This?
We called the one. Like, check
is this
out.
An actual power so glove?
Bad. Yeah, that's yeah. an actual power glove.
Oh, my God.
would you say it's so bad?
You see, we have the poster over there under the How to Tell Your Cat's Trying to Kill You. That came, the poster came with the power glove box.
That Ray Romano? Who's on that?
I fucking don't know, but I have his sunglasses. But we called the 1-900.
Corey Hart
Taylor. We called the 1-900 number on there, and then like some weird fucking episode, goddamn 21 or 22. It was a long time ago. We called the 1-900 number on the power. We the power glove. We got the zapper, the Nintendo zapper, and then a Volkswagen Beetle, and then our Rector Set dragster that I built.
I like the dragster.
I kind of do too, man. I really do. And then my gigantic ass rubber band ball I've been building since I was 10 years old. You know what's in the middle of that thing?
You actually made that for real? Did I touch it?
You pick it up. See how heavy it is. That's a solid rubber band, like to the middle. It took
wait, what, like you had 9-10 pounds?
Yeah, it took about until it was about the size of a golf ball to actually be the size, like to be a circle, because it was just a ball of rubber bands.
A sphere.
Fucked one up. Sorry.
Thanks, that's okay. Michael.
You just
Crichton's ghost.
You just re-added to it. It's a lot heavier than you would think it would be.
Yeah,
but agreed. Solid rubber band. It's 23 years in the making, so.
Jeez. Have you actually weighed it?
I haven't. I haven't.
Should. That's probably a good. I'm thinking like 8 pounds on there.
It's
might even more.
It's
good bocce ball.
It's pretty fucking stout, man. But
you're just throwing the yard out, everything just flies off. It's dead. Yeah. It's like, oh, fuck.
Or did you the world's largest rubber band ball, they actually dropped out of a plane down on concrete and it didn't bounce. It just exploded.
It's like, well, that didn't go as planned.
I know. Well, that, all your hard work, quotations. Yeah. Completely.
Like, oh, crap. All that for nothing.
Next up, a rubber band ball made entirely of old timing belts.
Jesus Christ. Well, it depends on who made them.
Continental Belts and Hoses.
Fair enough. What?
Fair enough.
So
they sponsor TST, so you gotta.
Fair. From 30 minutes.
Sponsor Spike. Anyway.
From 30 minutes ago, your favorite Primus song.
We're known as Big Brown
Beaver. I think that's going to be everybody's.
God damn it. Sorry, guys. Look, the setups in here is different.
I'm messing everything up. Sorry.
And I'm at the daddy mommy side of the table, and they're at the normal spots, and I keep hitting my fucking knee on
Yay,
the damn
kids
legs.
Table.
So my favorite Primus song is To Defy the Laws of Tradition.
The name of the song?
Yeah.
Oh. I probably never heard it. Be honest, I've heard.
You're about to.
I've heard it, but like trouble is like trying to remember what the hell these things are.
Well, everybody knows like My Name is Mud and
Jerry Was a Race Car Driver.
Jerry and the yep. Damn blue collar Tweakers.
Yeah.
This is. It's a joke on Rush. Primus isn't going to care we're playing this, so.
I'm going to fast forward.
That's fantastic. I love that.
Is it?
Yeah.
I think it's funny. No one really takes them seriously.
They're great,
but
yeah, it was that bass line, dude.
Yeah, but musically, they're.
And my answer is too many puppies.
Even too many puppies. Okay.
Too many puppies.
Larry Lalonde, the guitar player, underrated guitar player. Like, this is such a talented. Because you think, okay, it's a joke, babe.
What about
the
joke?
But
what
no,
about,
it's
what about
great.
The South Park theme song?
Exactly.
Yeah, that I mean,
but I think that kind of.
Is the
lends
epitome.
Into the, the fact that people don't really take them seriously as musicians. But.
Yeah, never mind like how well done South Park is to tackle everything and offend everybody.
Oh my God. I mean, they're on top of current events within like a week or two.
Mm-hmm. And
have you seen the documentary? Like, they might as well be whipping people into shape trying to make that show as fast as they do.
Oh, I'm sure, yeah.
And Emily did not know that they did basketball.
Oh, really?
Oh. Yeah. She had no idea.
You've got Playmate of the Year Victoria Silvstedt in the hot tub. Yes, I have. Playmate of the Year Victoria Silvstedt in the hot tub.
What about the
full title? Because I remember that one. Like, oh, goodness. Thank you, Sweden.
We watched basketball at basketball camp and Pfeiffer basketball camp when I was in, Jesus Christ, I don't remember what grade it was. It was a fucking long-ass time ago. But we watched it.
Yeah.
We watched that, and then we went to the movies and watched American Pie.
Oh, what about the lesser-known Orgasmo? You ever see that movie?
Did not see that.
By them?
I haven't seen it, but I'm pretty sure I have that one on DVD. Hey, remember those?
You should absolutely watch that one. It's fantastic. I actually liked it way better than basketball or baseball.
Basketball.
There's a lot of shit I need to... But I'm not a movie... Steven knows I'm not a movie watcher.
I mean, I've never seen The Godfather, so fuck me, right?
I have seen The Godfather, but I've never seen any Star Wars movie.
None of them?
None of them.
Really? Just watch Spaceballs.
I've seen Spaceballs a million fucking times. But I've never seen any Lord of the Rings movie, any Harry Potter movie.
So you've seen way less than me.
Yeah, I don't watch it. I fucking watch anything. And
do you watch anything at all? Like TV, movie?
I do, but I don't even carry my... I carry
videos on the YouTubes, man.
I don't even carry it into TV. Like, I've never seen any Breaking Bad or any the zombie fucking thing. What is it?
Walking Dead.
Never seen any Walking Dead.
Pick up that wine. The Quail Hollow Harris Teeter had the Cabernet from Walking Dead
for
$10. That I saw at Lowe's Foods for $20. Like,
wait, Quail?
Interesting.
Not the one across from Queens?
No, like close to the country club.
Okay, because the one at Queens is the one we play, the Harris Teeter wine bar we play at. And good
this,
lord.
This is a very plain Jane looking Harris Teeter right down the sidewalk from the fucking country club.
Okay, because I went to pick my check up, finally got paid for that gig.
Hey.
And I walk in, and then the lady working the front desk goes, "Are you the musician that's coming to pick up your check?" I'm like, "Yeah." Uh-huh. She's like, "I could tell by looking at you." I was like, "Cool." Why? She's like, she was asking me all these questions. She's like, "Hey, do you know Ricky Reichman from Headbangers Ball lives in Mooresville?" I'm like, "You have my attention."
Go on.
I was like, "What?" Wait, she's what? Like, "Yeah, I'm friends with him. I've known Ricky for years." I'm like, "That's neat." She's like, "Yeah, he runs a radio show podcast in Mooresville and has like local artists." And she was like,
"How do I spell
the
that?
Ricky Reichman from Headbangers Ball from MTV is in Mooresville?"
Holy cow.
And doing all this. It's like, "Huh? Okay, yeah, you have my attention now, crazy lady." She was just like, "Why?" She talked to me like we went to high school together, and like we actually
you were
enjoyed
just the guy
each other's
walking
company.
In. Yeah, no
yeah.
Idea,
it's
yeah.
Like Jesus, I just wanted my check at this time, but now you have
like,
my attention.
Wait, okay,
yeah. So she's just a cool chick. She was just one of those. She's like, "I'm not a groupie. I just love music." I'm like, "Fair okay. enough.
Fair enough. That's me.
You kind of seem like a groupie, but."
Because no one else knows he lives in Mooresville.
I'd fucking. None of us did. And we're pretty astute in the music genre. But no, I don't know how to spell that.
But what's Matt Pinfield up to these days?
Kurt Loder.
I think he's cool as shit, man.
I think he's modeling for Despicable Me. He like followed Metallica around during the Saint Anger like days. By the way, they played Saint Anger and Some Kind of Monster at a recent show, and Kurt put solos in it, and they play like it fucking sounded great. Like that album got a lot of hate for years. There's some songs on there that are garbage, but Saint Anger's not the worst album that Metallica ever put out. That would be Lulu with Lou Reed.
Name of the album was Lulu?
Lulu. And it was with Lou Reed from Velvet Underground.
I've never even heard of that album.
You're not missing any... Have you ever listened to any Velvet Underground or any Lou Reed?
Not really.
You're not missing anything.
Dandy Warhol's did the same thing, but better.
Yeah, that's true. It was. Look up Lou Reed and then... say fuck you, AJ. Okay. I don't ever want to hear this again.
I was pretty impressed with their new album, Hardwired.
Hardwired was good.
Because I don't know. You see pictures. I mean, you forget how old these guys are now, right?
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah,
they're
pushing 60.
And that was like made it big in the early 80s is now pushing 60. And
everybody.
And it was like Ride the Lightning type shit. Like, I just.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But that's why they don't need the money. They do it for they love.
They
love
just like
it.
To make music.
They do love. And here's some crazy. Like I'm. Are you a big podcast guy or not? Really,
I recently got into it.
I'm downloading that Ricky Rockman podcast now.
Nice.
The probably
Cat
a couple
House
months
Hollywood
ago.
Podcast is the name of it.
Nice.
But I'm always on like the true crime type stuff.
So you'll.
So which is your favorite murder?
I started out with the. What was the name of the podcast? But it was about Anand Syed.
Serial.
Yes. Serial is what really got me hooked. And then we watched the HBO documentary.
And I had the exact opposite reaction to that. Like, I was just bored stupid by Serial.
Really? You were bored
I didn't like it.
Do you like true crime stuff or
no? Like, the more bizarre stuff, like Last Podcast on the Left is pretty incredible.
That
is more, like...
Is that the Billy... What's like, that guy's name?
That's don't have for Steve. It's okay. Crazy shit. But it's true crime and paranoia.
We'll go with paranoia. Yeah, I like that.
The paranoia. That's when I have to put double the oil in my car.
No, I love paranoia song like, misery
yeah,
business.
Guys, 10W40 is the paranoia of 5W30, right?
It's math, dude. It's math.
Hey, major.
Hey, guys. This beer's working. Hey, major.
AJ confirmed.
That way that means we need more Brian's booze he just brought.
Yeah, you guys ready for next one?
Yes, do it. But about the pot, we were talking about podcasts on Joe Rogan Experience. James Hetfield was on there 2016, 2017. So not even that long ago.
You guys like IPAs?
Fuck uh-huh. Yeah. They just got the rights to their own catalog. Metallica did.
Just now?
From
their record label?
Just now. That's how lucrative that business. So I don't like any of the music that Chance the Rapper does, but he's on his own. He owns his own. He's his own bit. So
I had to stop eating Doritos because of that asshole.
You never stop eating Doritos. God damn it. That's a staple in this household, and I will not stand for such hobnobbery.
Not until Chance is off that, because those ads are garbage.
They're horrible.
They make me envy the deaf. No. Fuck you, Chicago. I don't care if you're such a sweet boy or whatever have you. No. Your music is hot garbage.
Anyway,
Steve doesn't like to take a chance.
They just got their right because when you sign, I think I've went over this with Steve before. But since you're new, so say you're an up and coming artist, and I'm a douchey record label, and I'm like, hey, Brian, I love your stuff. I'm gonna need you to sign this deal, and you're gonna be on our record label. And then you being a brand new artist go, shit, I'm getting a $500,000 or $1 million. I'm getting a $1 million record deal.
I made it.
$1 million record deal. Well, you have to record your album with that $1 million. So you have to get a producer and everything and eat and have your normal stuff. And then when your album is released, your record label goes, you owe us $1 million. That was a loan. And you go, what? And then the deal you sign is called a 360 deal. So now what they do, I would get a piece of all of your album sales, which is normal, and single sales, which is normal. I would get your part of your touring. I would get part of your merch. I would get part of anything
when
you
they
did
actually put no
with your fucking name on it. Yep.
Oh my God.
Anything you did. Yep. That's a 360 deal. So whereas in the 60s, 70s, you would sign the deal, they would give you the money, and then they would make their money back by your album sales and record sales, and you made your money by touring and merchandise.
Yeah.
You would go out and make your money touring. You make your money on touring.
You're the one putting the work in.
Yeah, absolutely. You don't make shit on album sales. Like, jack fucking shit. Nothing, zero, like, you hardly, unless you're Beyonce, Taylor Swift, that kind of thing.
Right, right.
You make nothing on that. You make all your money touring, which is why you see Chevelle touring all the time.
Yeah.
And I looked up Pete's network.
And you look at they're not playing like one show a month.
No.
They're playing every night. I mean, they're...
Yeah. Yeah.
5 days a week.
By the way, Chevelle's going on their 10th album this year. They're working on their 10th album.
Jeez.
Could you believe that? They started in 97, and they're going on their 10th album.
Wow.
And I looked up Chevelle's net worth.
Are they the opposite of the band Boston?
Look how big Chevelle... Chevelle's
the biggest band ever.
Look, Chevelle's a big band. Even though you're not a huge fan, you know the name. You know the name Chevelle.
Yeah.
Their net worth is $3 million.
That's it. They work their ass off.
You work your ass off.
My dad was very confused when I was running with him in traffic one day, and somebody had a Chevelle, the band, license plate frame on their car that was not a Chevelle. It's the, up, this is something.
The underlined V is the, yeah. the giveaway.
Oh, it's just like, oh, he grew up with that being a modern automobile.
Mm-hmm.
Or something. It's like, oh, why does it have a Chevelle tag on it? It's like, that's a band.
And actually on their amps, on Pete's amp, because they named their band Chevelle because their dad loved old Chevys.
Is that where that came from?
Yep. So they have a model car.
I'm going to make a tribute. Gentlemen, get ready for a Chevette. Chevette. Because the Citation is too fancy.
They have toy Chevelles on their amps. And do you know what amps and cabs Pete from Chevelle plays? Turn around. That one.
Mesa Engineering?
Same head, same cabinets. That's
awesome.
And if I were to turn that thing on right now and crank it,
that
you would go,
boogie, y'all.
Well, that sounds like Chevelle.
I mean, I don't know how I didn't realize that was behind me, but that thing's about 3.5 feet tall.
Mm-hmm.
Like it would just blow my headphones off.
Okay, so it goes up to 10. Spare me the Spinal Tap joke.
Not 11, right? Yeah. Anyone?
Come on. On two.
Yeah.
On two.
Why don't you just make 10 louder?
But these
so
go to 11.
Fine, I'll only give you half the joke then.
On 2 out of 10, in here, where it's at now, rattles the dishes downstairs in the cabinets.
Oh, my God.
And when I record, on 4.
What about these?
Actually, now what I do is I take that amp and I roll it in the spare bedroom and face it that way. And then I put my homemade doohickey in front of it to
sound
absorb
deadener.
The sound. Yeah, sound deadener in front of it. But I do that so I can hear.
Are you saying that's your Sonic Reducer?
Correct. But I'm no longer Sonic Youth. I'm Sonic Middle Age.
Dead Boys is the best band you're not listening to.
All right. But I put it in there, and then you can. I use my monitors, and I can hear what my microphone when I'm miking the amplifier. You can hear what sound is captured.
Okay,
from that. So, but no, it's fucking. It's stupid. It's stupid fucking loud. Like it's way overkill for, especially since I play nothing but acoustic in here. But
right.
But or not acoustic live, but I record obviously with that. I'll let you hear the new song I'm working on, and hopefully you like it. What is wrong with my damn? Sorry, guys. Let's see here. Being unprofessional today. Bryan, you just cracked open a beer for us. What are we drinking?
I did. So I've never had this before, but a coworker of mine brought this back to me from Nashville, Tennessee. From Southern Grist. This is Dancing in Details.
Which dancing in the details. Dancing in the details. If you have a chance to do it, advance dancing in the details.
I wonder where that name came from. It's a double New England IPA brewed with
Nelson. I've
been
wrong before, and I plan on being wrong again.
I've never heard a double New England IPA.
It's a double New England IPA.
It's very hazy. That looks like grapefruit juice.
An extra hazy, extra strong IPA.
It's fucking great, though.
It is very good.
It smells like it has like some kind of herb, like rosemary, or there's something in there that's catching my...
And a fresh new French hop. Barb Rouge, known for an intense, rich berry aroma and flavor.
Well, surrender to my taste buds, French.
7.9%.
God, that's fucking good.
It's
different.
Very good. Yeah, very good.
That's the thing now. It's like there's so many different styles. Like it has to be different and good to catch my eye now because there's so many different styles of beer now.
I'm not
it's
really
a
sure
lot,
what the
yeah.
hell a New England IPA is beyond hazy, but I really enjoyed that variety of them.
That's been a really, really good one. We still can't do the sours. He more so than me.
I'm adventurous. It's much like country music. I may not like it, but it's going to be something different for sure.
I'm still loving Black Hawk, the country band from the mid-90s.
That's her cell. Red Hawk, White Hawk.
I was thinking more of the Chicago hockey team.
Heyo!
Such great, 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 great music. It's really good. I'll swear by it. But good music is not genre specific because I am a grunge and post-grunge modern rock guy. But
grunge and thrash metal.
But I don't even like thrash that much. Like my favorite Pantera album is Far Beyond Driven. It's not Cowboys from Hell.
What?
I don't like. I'm not a thrash guy. Like my favorite Metallica album was, I hate to say it, but it was the Black Album.
Of course.
Because I thought these songs were better.
I agree.
My favorite Slayer album was Diabolus in Musica. It was not Rain and Blood. or south of I don't gravitate towards thrash. I like sludgy, groovy, like that. So, and you do too.
Yeah.
Where Steve's taste is, we're similar but different.
I think my go-to favorite band is Queens of the Stone Age. Because why not have a band that sounds like from the 70s, but they're current? That said, their last two albums will never be my favorites.
Well, when you're that creative,
if they're rated R, you betcha.
But it's when they're good. if you're that out there with your creativity though, like it's hard to top. Like it's hard to keep doing that because you just if you pour every like Ozzy one time he said that first album he goes most bands' first album is their best album because you have nothing to lose.
Right,
you got signed. This is like.
Or
now there's timelines, now there's pressure, now there's style, you know, now everyone knows you.
Or also with band's first album being their best, they've had their lifetime to work on this. Like, maybe you're 20 doing this, but, you know, you and your buddies have been working on this thing, you know, since you're teenagers.
Yeah. That's a 10-year album.
Now
all of a sudden it's like, we need one in 2 years.
Yeah. And you're really wondering, like, some of these bands that cranked out year after year, you know, 80s Iron Maiden, all right, 80, 81, 82, 83, 84, 85, 86, you know, they killed it during that. Not everybody had that much success with that time frame.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Do you remember, there was, I think it was Sebastian Bach, all right, from Skid Row. You're familiar.
Yep.
He said he would go into record stores when Skid Row was big, and he wanted to listen to new music. And he said, I would just peruse the metal genre, and I would pick the bands that had the ugliest fucking guys on the front.
and that's how they discovered Metallica.
Well, because like, that's how you know that they made good music, right? Because they're not glam rockers,
right? If you pick the ones with like pretty fucking looking guys and everything, you know the music's probably
mediocre.
Not great. Right. He's like, but you go through and look at Motorhead and Metallica and Megadeth and Anthrax. Like, okay, these guys don't fucking care about how the weather. They just want to put out the best fucking music
that's
possible.
That's really funny you mentioned Metallica in that the behind the music of Metallica, like somebody saying, like, this is the ugliest bunch of humans I have ever seen. Talking about them on the back of Ride the Lightning or Kill 'Em All.
Well, James isn't ugly. He just looks like the Cowardly Lion from The Wizard of Oz.
I mean, that's very true. You know, back in the early 80s, it's all them with giant hair with a severe case of Dillagaff.
You know what Dillagaff is, don't you?
I do not.
Do I look like I give a fuck? I think you need that for your license plate if that's not out.
Please write that down. I've been thinking of something to come up with.
Yep. I got it.
I was like, I don't have a pen.
No, I mean, going back to the one of my favorite bands is Linkin Park. Like, I grew up with those guys.
Oh, man. I think it was by the time I turned 20, it was like, I'm too old to listen to this anymore.
But that's the thing is, like, their music evolved. And I feel like I... Right, that's pretty funny. I like that.
I wrote down Axis Power.
We'll see if the DMV will let me do that.
I'm sure they fucking will. Did you see the one on the S2K?
What?
I did. Oh my God, 8K RPM. Fantastic.
Well,
did you see the one of mine that's really inappropriate because I can't drive for that service? Uber.
Your license plate says Uber?
I've had it for 15 years. Yeah, my license plate predates Uber the service.
Oh, man.
If I get the Viper, getting Dad Asp.
I always wanted to get an FSU plate because that's where I went to school, and I wanted to get
do that
A-Nole, A-N-O-L-E, but I don't know if they'll let me do it.
I don't know. Like in Kansas, on one of the Starion guys, he wanted Corruptor on his. They wouldn't let him have it.
Really?
He's like, really? You won't let
I
want to
go
it.
Like Seinfeld Ass Man. Like,
yeah.
Thanks, Kramer.
You are the Ass Man.
One of my favorites was on the three when I had my Starion, and we used to group up with the 3SI guys, the 3000 GT and Stealth guys, because there's not many of them and there wasn't many of us.
Yeah.
One of his says VR Forgasm. They let him have it.
Oh, they let him have fantastic.
That. Yep. I saw a Viper with Hiss with the S's. The NSA, the black NSA.
Just say HI dollar signs.
Yeah, the
Hi, money.
The black NSX.
More like goodbye, money.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
The black NSX. Blah, with exclamation points.
That's a good one. That's a good one, too.
There's so many good vanity plates.
I mean, for what it's worth, my car could easily get away with VIBR, digit the vibe 8, R, because of the Pontiac Vibe.
But his is the combination of my two cars.
Is it really?
Basically.
Oh.
I have box on wheels that revs at $8,000.
The Vibe goes to $8,000?
I have the GT model. That's why I was asking if...
it's a 6-speed with 100...
Your Previous had the GTS model.
100 horsepower per liter. 1.8, 100 horsepower.
I mean,
180
at 260,000 miles, I shouldn't, but it can.
There were those in the Matrix. No, like, the Matrix is...
I'm getting 30 miles to the gallon and getting about a quart per 1,000 miles. So it's becoming a hungry kitty.
Yeah.
But, you know, so long as motor oil stays at our prices, right, in British prices, we're good.
We're good to go.
You know, $4 a quart instead of 25, I could complain less.
Well, yeah. I told Bryan when he got here, I got my $32 worth of oil filters in the S2000. You know how many oil filters that is?
Uno.
Two. That's two. $16 per.
Jeez.
But they do require special oil filters.
Well, and as well as that would take six.
Oh, yeah. Middle door. Open a door until you see a toilet. And then piss into that one. If you see a bed, you're not in the right room. Steve, hand me that if there's any more in there. That's really fucking good.
There is.
You want some more?
Yes.
God damn, that's fucking good.
Is it more of his unzipped? It's like, dude, you hot bullet. What are you doing, man?
Everything's been good so far, but I didn't see I did not experience any of the licorice in the storming Florida, and I don't really mind that.
Storm of Florida Blanca.
Florida Blanca.
Florida Blanca.
Mm, yeah. It's sure.
Cheers, Mike.
Your brother's not here.
No. Like it's a month past his birthday, and I finally got the rest of his birthday present yesterday.
Nice.
He wanted Bluetooth headphones, so I'll see what I can do for $12 for him.
Luke from CAA has expressed interest in coming on the podcast. Okay. So I don't know. You haven't been to very many of the CAA.
I've been second Thursday a month is no longer a good time to do anything.
That dude
does not ring a bell.
Super fucking nice guy. You'll enjoy him.
Everybody there was cool, but like I haven't been to a meeting probably since I've been otherwise occupied.
I think they have 6 concerts to go to in September.
Goodness.
So they're going to Lacuna Coil, and then they're going to Arch Enemy, and they've went to Gojira. Like, they go to every... Like, nice. I was like, yeah, we're going to have Luke on, too. Like, cool. So that'll be a very music-heavy one, whereas this one has actually
been 33... All over the board.
This one's 33% each, and then 1% silliness.
We are us.
Dare we start doing this on Sundays?
I can tell you right away I'm late for dinner with the in-laws, but whatever.
Where's dinner?
House.
Oh. Oh, I think that you can be forgiven.
Yeah.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Yeah, if anything, my stomach's been killing me earlier part of the day anyway.
I got you. So what's on the what's on the dinner menu tonight at your place and your place?
My place, no, in-law's place, ham steaks and potatoes.
Ham steaks?
Yep. Basically, big-ass slab of ham.
Grilled?
Probably.
Nice.
Look at the weather. Is it good? Yeah.
It's too hot.
Matt does not care.
Fair. What's on your dinner menu tonight?
I've been cheating, and I went with a meal prep service that I've been doing for probably about 8 weeks now.
How is it?
I actually really enjoy it.
Interesting.
Yeah, my wife is vegetarian. I'm not.
Mm-hmm.
Her work schedule is different, so we kind of eat a little bit independently. So I started doing, the name is Freshly, and they're not frozen, which has been helpful because the food's actually...
That's a running gag with...
actually good.
It's good.
It's like fresh, not frozen. It's like, you don't refreeze your beef, man? It's like, yeah, refrigerator. It's going to be okay.
Yeah. By the way, don't eat at the Wendy's here in front of my house. And I'm not one to
Slowest nuggets ever.
No, I don't care about your sanitation rating if it's over 90, but if it's under 90, nope, then I kind of start to care.
Yeah, that's bad news. That yeah. Wendy's is bad news.
That Wendy's is bad news. It like, is. It was on that list of on the Charlotte.
Like, don't eat there.
Yeah. Oh, no. If it's on, well, yeah, the thing is,
the,
yeah.
I haven't eaten at that one since Kirkland was on, and we both went there.
Yeah.
But.
Got food poisoning?
I feel no worse than usual after that one. It's been a couple months. So now I know. Like, back yeah, to that the university that area store then. Get my spicy chicken and a Pepsi. It'd be all right.
I'm not saying that my lifestyle is correct, but here's the rundown of everything I've eaten today, okay? So I've had 3 cups of dry Cinnamon Toast Crunch for breakfast with 2 cups of coffee because I don't like soggy cereal, so I don't eat cereal and milk. So I just eat it out of a cup and drink
my
coffee.
My idea of that's going way different. It's like, yeah, you're just pour the coffee over your cereal. It's like, all right, well, eat it more quickly. Champ. You enjoy it. All
right. Don't lie, that's not
I brew well, coffee.
I have the best worst idea now.
I brew coffee with coffee.
Do you want to clog your coffee pot? Because that's how you clog your coffee pot. I got a spare coffee pot if you want to experiment.
Well, that was at 5:30 this morning when I got up, even though I went to bed at 1 a.m.
And you just got up at 5:30 because?
I had to work. Remember? I worked an 8-hour shift today.
He yeah. writes a schedule.
Yeah.
Sorry, I forgot.
So I got I did that, and then at 8:30 I was hungry again, so I had I made pulled pork the other night, so I had 2 barbecue sandwiches at 8:30. And then at noon, I sat down and ate a pound of boneless. Yeah, you did.
They match styles.
They do.
Yeah.
Well, at noon, I had a pound of boneless buffalo chicken nugget wings, a pound of those with honey mustard. Oh, yeah. And then we came here. Well, I ate a little snack before you guys came, and then we've been drinking all this beer. And then I'm probably going to eat something super unhealthy for dinner tonight,
absolutely.
Too. But when you walk 9 miles a day and lift 40-pound boxes. Yeah,
you can do that.
There's a good and a bad to everything, I guess.
Yeah. That's what I did my last day in Vegas was lift a bunch of 40-pound boxes and not walk 9 miles. Scratch that, reverse it.
Thanks, Missy Elliott.
Yeah. Most inappropriate song for a Kit Kat ad ever? Perhaps.
This is really fucking good. And that the hop they put in that, I swear it smells like rosemary. Or,
say it's new.
God damn, it smells good.
It's new. Barb Rouge. Known for its intense, rich berry aroma.
I like it. It does.
Yeah.
It's...
Roseberry.
But that's
have you seen that movie,
Nashville,
Roseberry's
Tennessee.
Baby? We're very punny here.
Oh,
so
I like it.
You better get used to it. Don't like it, you're in the wrong place. Yeah. Man, we've covered a lot of
Who's
shit
Who's your
here.
Favorite comic book character? Is it the Punisher?
I'm not a big comic book guy. That's why I don't I haven't seen any of the Avenger stuff. Any comic book movie that's not all of the
Blade.
I've seen every Batman movie, but I haven't seen anything. I grew up with Batman. Every Batman movie.
Who's your favorite Batman?
Well,
Kevin Conroy,
Val Kilmer.
He's my favorite saint. Sir Roger Moore.
Ben Affleck.
I think I'd rather have Val Kilmer there.
He's my favorite bad guy from Mallrats as well as Daisy Confused.
It depends. Like, because Christian Bale played a great Batman.
Yeah.
Michael Keaton played a good Batman, but it was two different Batmans.
Correct.
Batman.
All right, so what's your favorite movie? What's your favorite series? Do you like the Christopher Nolan or do you prefer the older?
I do like the Christopher Nolan ones. Yeah. It was a darker
realistic. I don't know if Batman can even be realistic.
No, the thing is, the grittier wannabe James Bond Batman really did well.
Yeah.
I hated the third one.
Which was that? Was that Clooney?
No, the third.
Oh, you're saying
Nolan.
The third
Batman
of the
Dark Knight Rises.
Yeah, you didn't like Dark
no,
Knight?
No, like,
really?
No.
Why?
Probably because at the time I watched it, I was sleep deprived and slept through half of it.
Yeah.
But like, it just seemed to drag more than the others did.
Fair enough.
Well, were you comparing it to The Dark Knight? And is that why
you didn't?
I try not to because it's like comparing albums.
You gave it the same fucking title. Yeah, let's tack on. All right, here's this name, and then let's add a word. Give it a different title.
How about The Bane of My Existence?
Yes, it is.
I'm wonderful. I'm particularly excited because I'm a guy who goofs with a mask.
Damn it, every beer is empty. I don't know what to do.
I have others if you need others.
Let's do others.
All right, let's do others.
Are you going to be okay to drive the brand new Supra home? I don't want you to have anything happen to that thing.
Turn on the thingamahoos. You'll be
all
right.
Yeah, I'll turn on all the assists and stuff.
It doesn't have autopilot. Yeah,
but he has everything except autopilot.
It'll keep me within the lane. I'll be fine.
By the way, here's funny. After 2 hours, it doesn't delete it, but it starts over. Yeah, and that worried us the very first time we went over the 2 hour mark. We're like, God damn it, do we have to do all this shit over again?
All right, so you guys call it. Do you want this this triple what's mixed with a sour?
What's the number?
Oh, the percentage?
Oh, college beer, not call a number. Damn it.
Now I gotta go pay the water bill. Y'all just decide.
You want to try something new or something you've had? Let's start there.
New.
Let's go new. All right. I agree. There's plenty of days for CBS.
Yes.
Maybe when it's not 100 degrees outside. So what did you think when you first heard Heath Ledger was going to be Joker?
I'm not the biggest fanboy, so I wasn't that upset about really anything surrounding somebody doing a thing. Like, what was he, the guy from A Knight's Tale?
Yeah, so you didn't have an opinion. Yeah, you were just like, sure.
Somebody's filling a role. I'm not that prepared to be that upset about somebody doing a thing. And the fact he killed it, and then one of the Olsen twins killed him.
Literally, yeah.
Oh, shit. You're in big trouble, mister.
I mean, I thought, and I'll be honest, I thought my first impression.
I keep getting him and Orlando Bloom mix up anyway.
I could see that. I mean, honestly, Heath Ledger could have been Legolas, and it would have been perfectly fine.
He wasn't?
Straight hair, not curly hair.
Not a big Lord of the Rings fan either. So,
nope.
They did a thing. Like they've been incredible. It's like, hey, this is not my thing.
Yeah, you either like them or you don't. I think
Clerks 2 nailed it.
Yeah,
first movie.
Which you know they're doing another
second
movie.
Third movie. Plop. Plop.
But no, I think my initial reaction.
Oh, what a relief this isn't.
My initial reaction of Heath Ledger being cast as Joker was very, and I don't know, I'm not even like a Batman purist, but when I heard Heath Ledger, I'm like, really? I just don't see that guy doing it.
Ugh.
And then
it seems more subdued than you would hope to have in the Joker role. Like Mark Hamill voicing Joker in the animated series.
Right. Which is very similar to a Jack Nicholson Joker, right?
Yeah.
Very silly, just over the top.
Yeah.
Right. That kind of stuff.
And here's a fun fact. Do you know who turned
Has
down?
See my marbles. It appears they're loose.
Who turned down the role of Neo in The Matrix? You're not allowed to say. Who turned down the role before Keanu Reeves said yes to it?
Tom Cruise.
No.
Damn it. Who?
Will Smith. He turned it down. Will you know Smith. What he took instead?
Men in Black.
Wild. Wild West.
Ooh, I was going to say Men in Black. Men in Black you would have done okay on. Wild
The most coverably racist movie ever, actually.
And, yes, and goodness. He laughs about it now. Will Smith's like, yep, guess what I turned down and took instead. He's doing okay. That's why he can laugh at it. Like,
and I guess, you know, hindsight, we have the unfair advantage. But even in, could you see Will Smith in that Neo role in Matrix?
I mean,
was it that different when he was in Omega Man? I Am Legend, whatever.
I can't do it. The thing is, I don't think I can be objective about that.
I don't know if I can either. Because I picture is Keanu Reeves.
And I've seen all three. I've seen
like
all three.
He defined
Matrix.
It, right?
The Matrices.
Like,
yeah.
And by the way,
the Matrices.
You don't like the Architect?
I actually love The Architect. I had to watch that scene probably 10 times to figure out what the fuck that guy was talking about.
Oh, yeah. It's a, which one did we go with?
We went with the new ones. The one
sour?
No one's had.
The one with the sour?
Yeah.
All right,
this one is Dis Lego Memnon.
I've got an open mind.
Yeah.
You know what? I've got an open mind.
You know what? If we hate it, dump it.
And while Steve is gone, I'm not bored with the S2K by any means. It's still a blast to drive.
Yeah.
And it's one of those cars you can drive all the time and not ever get tired of. But I kind of want to boost it.
Yeah.
Would you drive
it more if you boosted it?
I don't know. Don't know.
I'm actually more impressed with your self-control, honestly.
I mean, I could do it. I could call up LHT right now and go,
yeah,
put me in line. And you know what I like about LHT is they only take one car.
It'd be a monster.
They only take one car at a time.
Yeah.
They only work on one car.
Full attention.
Well, you know, he bought a brand new NSX, and he only kept it for 6 months. They put new charge pipes on. They fabricate everything in-house. So they make their own exhausts and everything. It's just
so it's handmade
two guys.
Stuff,
it's
right?
Two guys.
Yeah.
Yep. And the price? All right. So they did the Kraftwerk supercharger kit, everything. The clutch, flywheel, skunk 2 header, and they tuned it, dyno tuned it for $6,800.
That's honestly not
for
bad at all.
Bolting on 220 horsepower.
I mean, do the math, like dollar per horsepower, that's extremely cheap.
Yeah, and if you want...
Especially when you talk about custom work.
Yeah, and then they're like, hey, what color do you want everything powder-coated? Do you want your valve cover the stock red, or do you want us to do
that?
You want
match
to, yeah.
the other stuff,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Just anything, that's, yeah. That's awesome.
So, but if I got rid of it, I would... There's a very short list of cars. It would be a ridiculous first-gen Viper that's really clean. It'd be a V8 RX-7.
Yep.
Because I love the FD RX-7. The way it looks, but I hate the rotary engine.
I do too.
Sorry, Mark.
No, I had a friend of mine that had
one.
He
likes it so much, he got one too. What?
I love the Lotus Evora, but it's still unobtainium for me.
Yep. Best Camry ever.
And the first gen R8s are creeping down, but if I had an R8 V8, I would kind of want an R8 V10. And then I like
buying that one for fuel efficiency.
No. Well, I like the 911. I'm not a Porsche guy, but I like the 911.
I like a 911, absolutely.
But I would take the second gen Cayman.
See, the Caymans have grown on me.
The first gen, I don't.
Right. It was more Boxster.
It was a Boxster.
I already got you a 911.
You did. I love a first gen NSX. If they were a normal price, they should be. I'd have one right now.
Yeah.
They're not. They're not. I know what it is, and I know it's rare.
Counting.
A clean, because I would want the one with the 6-speed transmission.
Yep.
I want the one with the pop ups. I don't like the fixed headlights on those.
Right.
The last one I looked at was a 98, a white NSX, bone fucking stock, was $70,000.
That's a 90. You're 20 years old.
Yeah. 50,000 miles.
You're gonna start coming into some expensive ass maintenance 70. Beyond the 70,
and it's a fiberglass body. Which is
no, some
aluminum.
Asshole.
It's aluminum body, which is even worse. Actually,
if some shitheads and learn hits
how
you, like,
to weld aluminum,
yep. exactly.
Is it MIGs or TIGs? Which Russian airplane is this?
Big old titties, big old tiggies. Here's my fun fact. Like, you buy the NSX for the presents, because if you look at Nürburgring times, which I'm not a big fan of, but if you're gonna look at them. The S2000 and the NSX run almost identical Nürburgring times. That's hilarious.
Yeah.
What if you're buying it for performance, like, what you're paying for the exclusivity. That's it.
If you strictly want straight line speed,
mm-hmm.
go American anyway.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So
it's all about
if
the
you
feel.
Want stupid caveman speed, like a Mustang or some, sure. Go spend 50 grand and get like 600 fucking horsepower.
Grand Tour Season 3, Episode 1, you betcha. Yeah.
I haven't had this yet, so
cheers.
Cheers.
Thought I could share it. It's actually better than I remember. It's I think it's mellowed a lot. This bottle's
that's a
pretty
good
old.
Glass of apple juice.
That's really good. No, that's not sour at all. That's fantastic.
I think it's mellowed a lot.
Yeah. What year?
I gotta look it up, to be honest.
That's really good.
Yeah, that's mellowed nicely. They used to date all their shit. I don't know if my dates wore off or...
I can't do that. I'm married. But it's a great time to be an alcoholic and a gearhead.
That's what really got me to jump into the Supra is I always have a list of things I want in a car.
Mm-hmm.
And I've gotten to the point where I'm extremely picky.
Mm-hmm.
So I can eliminate a car very, very easily.
Yeah.
So once I go through my hit list, I usually end up with literally like one or two cars.
Yeah, you and I have had this conversation at POUR a couple times because I'm not a brand specific guy, and you're clearly
I'm not
either.
No, I've been all over the place.
Every time I see like Z06 C7
mm-hmm.
go by, every time I'm like, especially if it's in a good cut, like the white with the black wheels, the red with the black wheels is a good color. Every
with
time
little
like,
fender stripes.
Yes.
Yeah.
Every time I'm like, fuck, that's goddamn pretty. Yeah. I don't know if I can have one. You just see them everywhere. You see Corvettes everywhere.
So I mentioned this way, I guess it's been hours ago now. The
that's
uniqueness.
When you need a Z06 FD. You're welcome. Ooh,
God, yeah, yes. Seriously. I mean, but
have some fun with Frankenstein.
So this new Vette came out and you know, I'm 37 years old. My dad's in his early 60s. He's a Vette guy, right? Mm-hmm. So he had this fantastic Grand Sport in his garage, and I love it.
And my dad's got a buddy who is.
What year?
2008.
That's a C6.
C6.
Yeah. Yep.
Fantastic car. Loved it.
Mm-hmm.
Updated interior. The thing was a fucking rocket ship.
Yeah.
But I think of myself in one, and I just don't see it yet. Maybe I will. I'm sure I will.
Mm-hmm.
Because you can't deny the performance of a Vette.
Mm-hmm.
So when the C8 came
out,
the
sheer inexpense to speed they have to offer. Yeah.
Oh my God, you're talking 60,000-80,000 in your supercar numbers.
Yes,
like unbelievable.
Especially now,
or even
the
now,
C8 is unbelievable.
Did you see the top speed of the base C8 now?
No,
196. That's the base model
at $65,000 or something. I mean, it's unreal.
Yeah.
So I expect I'll probably go down that path sometime.
Mm-hmm.
And I was really considering it. As I was hunting this most recent, but then once the Supra kind of took over because I figured I'll get to the Vette eventually.
Mm-hmm.
The Vette's always going to be there. They're always going to
they're
make
not
going to
go away.
They're not
speaking of Vettes, you see the C4 on 51 between here and Idlewild.
Yeah,
oh,
I still throw around a ZR1 C4. That's still
that was a pretty
4.50-6. In 1992.
Rocket ship.
Which is nuts.
Nuts.
And the engine built by?
Mercury Marine
boat engines. Yamaha engine.
Really?
Yeah.
I did not know that.
Yeah. It's a 4-cam. It's not a push rod. It's dual overhead cam. Oh, shit. Yeah. Yeah, that car was stupid at the time. Like, it stickered at 58 grand in 1990.
Yeah, when a standard Vette was, what, 40?
Yeah. Or my dad's
generous ransom.
My dad had the Conquest, and I had the Starion, but he bought his Conquest brand new in 87.
Same diff.
In December of 87 as an 88, and paid $22,000 in 1988, which nowadays is a $50,000 car.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And it's funny, because that car didn't even have airbags. It didn't. No
just
airbags.
A shell with a motor.
Power steering. Rear wheel only ABS.
It's all sophisticated engine.
Yeah.
You know, and
heated mirrors in 88.
Really?
Eight-way, the stereo was eight-way equalizer. Yeah, it was insane. Everything beeped.
That's like way before
everything you
time.
Touch beeped. Digital climate control. It was like, it was 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 8 gauges in the cluster.
Holy
like,
cow.
It was ridiculous. It's insane amount of ridiculous shit in the 80s. And it was great.
So let me ask you guys.
And automatic choker belts, y'all.
Yeah.
Somehow that managed to surpass or be in conjunction with airbags. Yep. the car's going to choke you now.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, the automatic seatbelts. Yeah. They all said turbo. It said turbo on them.
Yeah. So let me ask you guys this. How does Corvette do it? They have the name recognition.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
They have the following.
Mm-hmm.
They have specs. Do they just do it out of the goodness of their heart?
I don't know.
Like, we're going to make essentially a supercar, an American Ferrari, right?
Mm-hmm.
The C8, right? American Ferrari.
Because Ford couldn't buy Ferrari,
yep.
But that's a completely
So they have no competition as far as the domestic.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So maybe they don't have to? Or they want to keep it affordable because they know their client base?
It's got
to
be that.
It's got to be it.
Got to be. And they realize with the previous generation that they've reached a limit of how fast you can make front engine car go.
And that's where we discussed this. I was like, I was fine with Chevrolet or General Motors making a mid-engine car,
sure.
A supercar. I don't know if I would have called it the Corvette. Because the Corvette
Agreed.
From 1953 has mm-hmm. been a front engine rear-wheel drive car.
Yep.
And that's been something teased on one of the car mags was 17 issues they did that.
Yep.
Teasing the mid-engine Corvette?
Yes.
Oh, yeah, it's been since
and
the
now
70s.
Like it 20, became right, a yeah. reality now.
Yeah.
It's taken them 66 years to make that be a thing.
But I'm I am sort of a traditionalist.
Are
so
you?
When I found out that the Supra was
if
part
you're
BMW,
that
I was like, I don't know. I don't know if it's going to work. Now, the
I like it because I can drive a BMW without driving a BMW.
Nice.
That is true because
I hate the stigma that comes with the BMW.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yes.
I
don't wear gold aviators, so like, I don't
Or our buddy Mark, who we tease all the time. We love him
I
to
do,
death.
But they're very knockoff. They're so knockoff, they still say Ray-Ban, but they cost me $8.
I do have a real set of Ray-Ban, but they're Wayfarers, so... But we
he's got the ones that are tilted and the ones that are really tilted. Like,
yeah, really tilted.
Really tilted.
Our buddy Mark was about to buy a Z4M and bought a Mustang GT instead. I was like, you're the first fucking person in the history of the world that has ever cross-shopped those two vehicles. He autocrosses it and everything. Like,
does he really?
He does pretty good.
That shit's set for a year. What are you talking about?
Well, he has a daily now. He has a
Civic Si.
04 Si.
The hatchback go-kart.
Yeah. But
ooh, I always loved the hatchback. The little B-Series?
Yeah.
Hell
great.
Yeah.
That's a great car. But I was like, you're the first person ever that was going to buy one of these. Because I was like,
with a Mustang.
That's very phallic looking. The Z4M of that.
Well, so that was my initial thought with the Supra.
You thought it was going
to
be
like
that.
I was like, it looks like a fucking Z4. I was like, that's exactly what it looks like to me. And it does. There's some resemblance there.
Yeah.
It's got the long hood. It's got a short back.
Not enough to.
And now the
but
Z4
once I saw
is
it,
only
it's
convertible.
Not,
they right. The Z4 coupe hatchback is gone, so
mm-hmm.
kind of fills that gap, but no. kind of doesn't.
But I love the original Supra. Like, I love the...
That's
no, you don't.
9.5. I like the 9.5.
That's what got
that's
me.
That's a Mark IV.
I like
the
Mark IV. The,
if, like, you do not love a 1980s Supra.
I do not like
nobody
it,
does.
No.
No, it's the Mark IV.
The,
I love the Mark
IV. The second, third, fourth gens, yes, you do. First gen, no, you don't. That
so
is
that's what
not
got
a looker.
Me.
That is not a performer. I'm wondering how the hell that didn't get shot from the get go. No,
it was the 80s, man. Everything was ugly in the 80s.
Hey,
from the
80s. We were all born in the 80s.
Exactly. You see me over here?
Speak for yourself, man.
Yeah.
I'm holding
Dude,
on to my
I've,
handsome.
I've got my self esteem issues, but today's not it.
I consider myself a 90s kid, but
I mean, what the kittens?
I ended up being kind of born in between the super phase. So when the Mark IV was out and popular, you know, I kind of missed that boat. It was a little bit before my time. So then when I knew they were going to redesign it and stuff and come back, I figured this was my chance.
Fair. I told Steve this on a couple podcasts ago. My dad's boss had 97, or no, he had a 95 NSX and a 95 Supra when they came out. And this was in the mid-90s, too. So when I saw them, I just fell in love. I was like,
of course. Yeah. I mean, those things were groundbreaking. So
that's when I fell in love with them. And then Fast and Furious came out. And then I got my license in 2002. I'm a little bit younger than you two guys. But I got my license in 2002. And that was when the internet was very young anyway. And I was just looking at car prices. And Supras could be had for not cheap, but $25,000
obtainable.
$27,000. Fucking good luck with that now. NSX,
I was gonna say,
is
even now you can't. No,
not a fucking chance. Right. And now that when I looked at the CR prices on S2000, I was like, you got to be fucking kidding me! Like, really? That kind of makes me want to hang on to it just a little bit longer.
I mean, if you're good enough to recognize it, that's the thing. You don't know what's gonna stick and what's not.
Of course not.
Right? So
yeah, my dad had a 71. I think it was the Sublime Green Hemi Cuda, 4-speed.
Yeah,
and he sold it in 72 for fucking $4,000. Like, who would have known? Like, nobody would.
Nobody
knows.
Nobody knows.
But on top of the gas crunch that would have happened a year later, that car would have cratered then.
Oh, of course. Yeah. I'm matching numbers. Any Mopar car from there is a 6-figure car. Any of them.
Have you guys ever been to RK Motors in Charlotte?
I haven't, but I've heard of them, but I don't know anything about them.
You have to go.
Really?
I went up there with Nick last weekend. They had
my old neighbor Nick.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. 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 What? So they do a monthly car show. So people ride up there and display their own personal cars.
Mm-hmm.
But they have this showroom that is just anything, old Chargers, you walk in, the first thing you see is a Ford GT next to a Testarossa, next to an old...
Goodness.
Oh, man, it's fantastic.
That's my favorite hair color. You know what Testarossa is in Italian?
Redhead.
Testarossa.
That makes way more
Redhead.
Sense.
Redhead, yep.
Yeah, that makes way more sense. But, I mean, they have Mustangs and Chargers and SSs and...
shit, they're on Lakeview. That's close to my work.
Oh yeah,
yeah. North Charlotte, but it's worth the drive. If you go there for an event, they open up the showroom and stuff.
How often are the events?
I think they're once a month.
Okay.
Next one listed is the 14th of September.
Yeah.
Then October 12th.
You said 14th of September.
November 9th.
Yes. What am I doing that day? I can't make it to your bottle shit because I got a show that night, but I'm open that day.
Understood.
The artist formerly known as Grumpy Monk. And we're at Noda that Friday.
Oh, nice.
Yeah. The music's going to start being good to me again, I hope. I'm at the Radwood phase where I'm kind of liking seeing obscure, really clean examples of things than I am super duper exotic. Unless it's like, all right, so what is the prettiest car in your opinion? Like the prettiest car that was ever made.
Ever made.
Like, your favorite, best-looking car ever made. Because I already know mine.
You go. I don't know if I could answer that.
Miura. Lamborghini Miura. And just type in the Miura SV. Miura. Miura SV. As far as I'm concerned, especially coming out in the late 60s, that's the prettiest car that's ever been made. Steve?
I'm going to be kind of crunched here between something already mentioned or the 50s BMW 507.
I haven't seen that. You need to pull that up on your big-ass tablet.
Yep. Yes, please, kill the battery in this again before I kill it on my phone.
This one, this guy?
Yeah.
Don't blame me there. Kind of got the old school. It reminds me of a GT. It reminds me of what Ford was trying to mimic.
Yeah, and the thing about it is, could you imagine in 1969 seeing that
as a spaceship? And going, you're like, what the fuck?
What is that?
What is that?
And when you opened the door, when you looked at it from the front and the doors open, it had no top. It looked like the horns of a bull looking at you.
Really?
Yeah, it was. That's gorgeous. That's pretty.
That's
Show Bryan that.
That's
pretty.
What they were aping with the Z8.
That's pretty.
Oh, yeah. What is it? A BMW 507. Looks fantastic.
I've never seen that before.
I haven't either. I don't blame you at all. Excellent choice.
That or an FDR X7.
I love the FDs so fucking much.
And the Miria. Or a Going Benz.
That's the angle and everything.
Yeah.
60.
Yeah, there was one of the Cars and Coffees that you didn't make it to. I got a picture of an orange one.
Jesus Christ, man.
Oh, did you really?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
They are going for stupid fucking money.
2 million now?
No, try quintuple that.
Goodness.
It's 8 digits now.
Holy cow.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. It's stupid how expensive those are now. Although the original Lamborghini, one of the originals, the 400 GT, I would still rock one of those.
Yep.
That's pretty awesome.
Yeah. Do you know the original story behind Lamborghini is that Ferruccio Lamborghini was a tractor maker, and he bought a Ferrari, and he had a few quibbles with it. And so he wrote a letter to Ferrari.
Shit. I'm gonna make my own.
Yeah, and he's like, "Hey, I like your cars, but I want you guys to make me one. But this needs to be changed. This needs to be changed. This needs to be changed." And Enzo Ferrari told him to fuck off.
Yeah.
And so he's like, "Fuck you! I'm gonna make my own car." And that's how it started.
Damn, it's like Hatfields and McCoys.
Yeah, kind of is. Yeah. Like, and so he's like, "You know what? I'll make my own car, and it'll be better than yours." But I don't know because.
I actually consider them different, not necessarily.
They're way different. Like, Ferraris are more about all out, how fast can I get around this track? Kind of like McLaren is, and Lamborghini's like, how ridiculous can I make this
look at me.
Particular vehicle?
Yeah.
But that's the thing about the cars I like, because I want it to be, I don't need it to be the fastest, because there's somebody faster always.
Always.
It needs exclusivity. I want people to go, what the fuck? I haven't seen one of those in years.
I love it. Call it ego, call it whatever you want.
I haven't seen one of those in years. I've never seen one of those. What the fuck is that?
What is that?
Yeah. My dad used to have one of those. Or something cool like that. I mean, because you don't see many S2Ks. You don't see many FDR X7s that aren't beat to shit.
Those are tough.
Yeah. Corvettes and Mustangs are a dime a fucking dozen.
That's what turned me off of the C8. I figured, and you know what? Even if I get one first, in about 3 months, they're going to be fucking everywhere.
Yep. And then you can just get really good deals on C7s.
And then you can just go pick up a C7. Yeah. Exactly. Go pick up a C7 for about 35
grand. But you know what? That last gen C7 with a manual transmission is probably going to be
a good investment piece.
A pretty good investment.
And it's a damn good looking car. We just saw one at the car show, and it was like,
remember,
really dark gray. Black accents, and that thing looked like a stealth fighter.
Do you remember the one at Poor that night when we the party?
Yes.
That was a Z06.
Yeah,
and he's like, I'm just gonna keep it forever because it's gonna. I was like, yeah, you're not gonna. Nothing's gonna fuck with you on the street. The street, there's a limit. Even at the top of third gear in the S2K, you're going to jail, most likely.
Right.
I mean, it's pretty high up there. So
yeah.
How fast do you want to go? And even the new Supra, as quick as it is, I mean, you're still going to be able to use most of that power on the street. I think so.
Yeah.
There is a limit. Like, oh, I got 1,000 horsepower in this. Yeah, that's cool.
Yeah, big deal. I'll see you at the next stoplight.
Exactly.
Yeah. So, but with the Supra, that's a proven drivetrain that people have tweaked this to 800 horsepower to make crazy runway runs in these cars.
Yeah.
Although a friend of mine who had a Starion, a really clean gold Starion, which I'm not a really big fan of that color, but he had bought
when gold he got majority, out, that's about it.
He got his first big boy job in the early 90s, and he bought a 93 Supra, a white one, 6-speed manual, and all he did was put he kept the stock wheels, which were Smarties,
mm-hmm.
you know, 16s, so he has a nice set of 18-inch wheels, gunmetal gray. He has the front and rear tail lights from Australia, which were made of glass, actual glass, which are super clear. Like, they're pretty. And
yeah, plastic fades if you look at it wrong.
Intake, header, exhaust, single turbo. He's making 550 horsepower, and it's the cleanest, smoothest Supra. And I was like, my God. When are you going to sell it? He's never.
Never.
This will be my coffin.
Never. Yeah, I wanted to show you a picture.
Then we're digging it up.
From
and
RK.
You're running shotgun.
Yes.
I know you like unique cars, and this kind of reminded me of
Do you know how you catch a unique rabbit? Unique up on it.
It's a GLHS.
Yeah, goes
like hell.
Yeah.
Shelby.
Yep.
Yeah. And it's and that little wagon
looks
just so awesome.
They're same engine as the Starion.
Was it really?
2.6 inline four.
Which is funny because I had neighbors that had a pair of Omni Horizons.
Yep.
Neither of which would have been the Go Fast models.
With enough nitrous.
No respect to those. It's like, oh, they got some weird hatchbacks. Oh, wait, that's all I'm buying now.
That is true.
How about that one? So that was on the showroom. It's a Callaway Vet.
Callaway's next level.
You know how much they're selling that car for?
$200,000.
No.
$60,000.
60 grand for a 1,000 horsepower car?
Yep.
I mean,
fucking monster. But because it's a vet, everyone overlooks it.
Yep.
Yeah. Because, I mean, to the
but
untrained eye.
But I walked in, I'm like,
how
has no one bought this? Like, this is ridiculous.
To the untrained eye, a ZR1 looks like a base model.
Yeah.
To the untrained eye.
Yeah.
People like us, we're nerds. We'll go, that's, you know, ZR1, Z51 package. Blah, blah,
like,
blah,
do you understand what you're looking at?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. But the guy in his New Balances and his jorts.
He does not know what he's looking
at. A CTSV would be quite entertaining.
Fuck.
Particularly for these sleeper values. Like,
gotta
like
be
first gen.
Great daily. See it. But my dad is thinking about buying a Challenger.
I'm not prepared for that triple fuel bill, though.
No. But my dad's thinking about buying a Challenger. And I'm like, Pops, you're 72. Mom doesn't work, and she's never worked. If you kick the bucket, who's fucking paying for this car? I hate to be morbid about it, but
he's liquidated, man. He just
don't buy a new one. Well, they've been around 10 years.
I was like, look, you guys are getting old, and it's hard enough. He bought a brand new 2000 Eclipse GT when that came out, and he still has it, and it's in good shape.
Really?
That was the car I saw them roll up, and that's the only time I met his folks was in that car.
Yeah, it's still in good shape, too.
That's fantastic.
But I was like, look, you guys are already having a hard time getting in and out of this car. I was like, if you want a fast car that you can get in and out of, I was like, just go buy a Jeep Grand Cherokee SRT8.
Trailblazer SS.
No, I'd rather have the Grand Cherokee because you get the Hemi in that, buddy. Yeah. He's a Mopar guy anyway. But 425 horsepower in a Jeep Grand Cherokee. By the way, if I win the lottery, I'm having the first Hellcat XJ.
That'd be fantastic.
It would be. And I have the 6-speed out of the Challenger in it. So it'd be a 6-speed Hellcat XJ. By the way, that'd be stupid because that thing weighs, this is no joke at all. That Jeep weighs a little over 100 pounds more than the S2000 does. Is that not bonkers?
How is it so light?
It's two-wheel drive. It's a unibody SUV, too. They're not body on frame.
Something dating back to 84 for its initial design.
What
they did in 97 was add a few more rounded corners to it. But
it was the first crossover SUV in 80. When they built it, it was not body on frame. It's all unibody.
So how the fuck does it get such bad gas mileage?
It's a square.
Fair the enough. Engine.
They're driving a cardboard box.
The engine is from the 50s.
Yeah, it's a 2-valve per cylinder push rod inline 6 4-liter with 190 horsepower.
Okay, there you go.
But still a damn sight faster than Gray's V6
that
Wrangler.
That is the worst way to go to Atlanta or NOAA. Yeah.
And you know why we discussed this in the last episode. You know why the Cherokee's better than the Wrangler? Because Barbie never drove a Cherokee.
Do you guys like Wranglers?
I like the idea of having something I can take the body off of.
Sure.
That said, I'm upset you can't do that without a Sawzall to an FJ Cruiser.
No, because the Wranglers you see lifted all have tire shine on them.
Right.
And yeah. I'm sorry.
They're not off-roading anyway.
I'm sorry, yeah.
Pretty.
It'd be like me lifting mine. It's two-wheel drive. I'm not opposing
it. You're not doing anything.
No, I'm not doing it. Like, don't lift it.
To me, it makes me angry. They just make me angry.
The angry eyes on the... Fuck.
Dude, those are so atrocious.
Die in a fire.
It's like a frat boy SUV. Like, they put stuff on it. They don't do shit.
Yep.
Off-road.
You spend a lot of money to not do anything with
shitty gas mileage. Shitty sound system.
You know what they do?
Drive Exxon style.
They all drive together. And then, for some reason, they think it's cool to park their...
On the curb.
Front tire on the other Jeep's front tire, and then they all park crooked together. That just like
sounds
I'm
like
sorry.
A gangbang. I don't like it.
It really fucking is. It's like a big homosexual Jeep gangbang.
I want
gangbang.
To Domino's them, not the pizza.
Yeah, that'd be fantastic.
Goddamn, I want some pizza. I'm really fucking hungry. The food I have, I don't want. The food I want, I don't have.
And the food that's fastest will kill you.
The Mexican joint here, Taxco's not bad for the price. Steve and I usually hit up Taxco after podcasts because it's cheap and it's
right
walking
there.
Distance. Yeah, exactly. What was on your dinner menu tonight? The prepared meals.
Yeah, but I'm open to suggestions.
I think, can live to see another day.
Well, my wife's already texted me, like, what's going on for dinner? I was like, you're on your own.
Yeah.
I like to say yo-yo.
Yes.
Well, you're already late for dinner, too.
Yep.
Do we call this and go Mexican?
You should get the Mexican.
All right.
It's good.
You want to call it now and then go Mexican?
Let's do it.
Well, we almost made it to 3 hours with Bryan. Can you believe
Damn.
That?
Damn.
That's insane.
That's effortless.
Effortless.
It's effortless. So
I love it. Fantastic.
That's been a lot of fun. And, man, Steve's already got his new upgrade for car ready when he gets new job. So he's just going to... One up the vibe tricks to
do it.
The Corolla.
Do it.
Well, the Corolla wagon with the 6-speed.
It'd be funny to get the 1-year Scion version of it.
What was it called?
The Scion I Am.
That's right.
If it's a Toyota Auris, anywhere else.
You should get that. You should get the badges. I'll help you put them on.
Absolutely.
Bryan, it's been a pleasure.
Thanks for having me. That
Isn't
was fun.
It a lot more.
Glad you could finally make it.
It's a lot more effortless than you would think it would be.
It really is. Now, I feel like it'd be something I'd look forward to now.
Of course.
It's like, why you got to do a thing? Like, hey, what's this thing you like? Tell us about it.
Exactly.
Now, I'll probably never go back and listen to this because I don't want to hear my voice on
That's cool, I don't.
But.
It's fine. I get to hear my voice and everybody else. I do all the editing anyway. So. But I enjoy it. Well, Bryan, thanks for coming, and for episode number 40, we will be back in 2 weeks or so. Steve's going to be in Rhode Island, but for episode 40, I'm AJ.
Still Steve.
I'm Bryan.
All right, guys, we will see you soon. The CBG Pod.
41, Threedles.
Later.